This is Screen Junkies Movie Fights, brought to you by NatureBox. Now your host, Andy Signore.
Greetings, Screen Junkies. Welcome to another episode of Movie Fights. We have some amazing topics, but even more amazing guests. No pressure to these guys, but I'm so excited because they're three funny guys that I love. Today we're going to be fighting stuff such as improve a movie by adding King Kong, what actor should reprise their iconic superhero role when they're old, and pitch a reboot of any Jean-Claude Van Damme movie. So lots of fun stuff we're talking about today. Let's get straight to it. You guys know at home, if you're watching live, can do hashtag Movie Fights Live to chime into the conversation. Dan Merle will be checking the couch, fact checking as always. Thank you, Dan. Let's get to the guests, though. I'm so excited to have him here. First up, I've loved this guy for so long, since Human Giant, so many amazing things. You can currently see him on the Go 90 series Drive Share, Paul Scheer.
Thank you so much. Very excited. Now, I'm confused, though, and I don't know if you thought this, but I thought this was just like a Murder, She Wrote recap show where we... I watched an episode.
I watched so many Murder, She Wrote
episodes. Yeah, I didn't know which one it was going to be. That's a hard thing. I thought that was the confusing
thing. I saw six episodes and she solved every single
she's
murder.
She's good.
Angela Lansbury is a good answer, yes.
She's very solid.
When is she going to finish that book she's been working on?
I like the fact that you are wearing the headphones. We're not. You look like a ring that, announcer. You look like you're
directions
calling
and things.
Oh, yeah, you're getting
but you don't need them. You can hear yourselves.
Yeah.
But wow. We're not. That's not it. We're still. I'm so happy to have one of the stars of Silicon Valley in the movie. I'm so excited coming out this summer. The Big Sick. Congratulations. I hear amazing things. It's Kumail Nanjiani. Thank you so much for coming.
Hello. Hello. Very close approximation of my name. No, you're good. It's a complicated name.
Everyone knows I'm terrible with names.
It's totally
even
fine.
Even when I like them.
Even I'm not sure how to pronounce it. I am totally not offended.
Kumail, thank you so much for being here. I'm such a fan. But I hear such amazing things about Big Sick with this film. We talked about it on news. We'll see it later. But I'm so proud. You're proud of this movie. I know, but I've heard amazing things. Tell us a little bit. It's coming out this summer.
Yeah, it's coming out this summer. It's a comedy, and it's sort of based on the real-life story of me and my wife, Emily Gordon, when we first met. That's sort of the first year of the relationship. And Ray Romano's in it, and Holly Hunter's in it, and Zoe Kazan's in it, and, A.D. Bryant, Bo Burnham, Kurt Braunohler, Michael Showalter directed it, Judd Apatow produced it. So, it's coming
hitters.
Out. Yeah, it's good. It'll go wide July 14th. It'll come in select cities June 23rd. The Big Sick. Please watch it.
We will remind you all closer to the date. But yes.
Yeah, that's because you're giving people a lot to do. I mean, because that's a high one. Right now, my show is on Go 90. You could just go there right now.
Yeah, well, you can watch Silicon Valley now, starting now, the new season.
Well, no, April 16th.
Even that is
the way. Yeah, you got to get...
23rd.
23rd.
Even longer than you thought.
Wow.
So even the thing that's coming up next...
I'm on Veep, and that starts April 16th. I can put it in your Siri.
Veep starts April 16th?
Yeah, that's why I was wondering why they didn't...
I've done a Siri reminder for shows. It's really helpful.
Really?
Yeah, you say, remind me on April 16th.
It's very important. Don't watch Veep. Watch Silicon Valley.
Wait a second. There's no
very
competition
important.
Here. They're on the same night on
it's
the same channel.
It's called Movie Fights, bro.
Oh, fuck. I'm already losing.
And
all
right, you guys are up against a legitimate fighter here, so no pressure there. He knows how to play here. He's our Honest Trailers writer, Spencer Gilbert.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm the Washington Generals of Movie Fights. You guys are going to do great.
You always lose?
Pretty much.
Good.
I mean,
he's experienced.
Okay, these guys do know their movies more than me, but they're also funnier.
Yes.
So this should
be good.
That's
true. Pressure on. You
oh
know,
my
like,
god!
A lot,
this is like move.
A lot of pressure. It's a lot of pressure. Anyway, so this episode starts off with a body in the lake, and I didn't know how Jessica Fletcher was going to deal with it. You know,
I hope we find out.
I don't remember the show very much, but is she like, hey, I'm a writer, so I can handle this? What
she's
does she
like
do?
Old. She's like an older version of Castle. I believe. So yeah. Castle is like a novelist who writes about
They reach out for
murders.
Help from the crime novelist
yes.
to solve the mystery.
But is the murder always in her tiny town?
I think sometimes she goes to other tiny towns and then there's a murder.
Can you help me with another one? Because I watched Eraser and it had the painter from Murphy
movie?
Brown.
Yes.
Was he always... Did she just have a painter in her house all the time?
Yes, but that was a running gag. Like, Murphy Brown had two of the funniest...
I couldn't remember that.
The funniest bits on Murphy Brown was every week she had a different secretary.
That's
and
right.
And the painter never left. And then the final episode is like, I finally finished your
That's
house.
That's right.
It's a very emotional
so
thing.
So satisfying.
But literally, she would always talk to the painter.
The painter is my favorite
for several
role.
Seasons.
Several. From episode one to the end, her house is always under construction. Because she was getting better. It was a metaphor. But the painter also...
You just ruined Murphy Brown for me. I don't want metaphors in my movie. movies.
It was.
Tell me the. Can I swear?
Sure.
Tell me the shit directly.
This is a. It's a. Yeah, oh, man. Murphy Brown. That painter was the guy from Beverly Hills Cop.
Yeah, too, he's in a lot of stuff.
Who meets with Axel Bronson Foley.
Pinchot?
No.
Do you remember his name?
Robert Pastorelli.
Yes. I was wow. on the tip of my toe. He's Oof. Good. Wow. All right. This is going to be fun. Before we start, let's yes. get to it. But off, on the couch there, Dan Merle, our champion, will be fact checking throughout the show. So
yes,
if questions
I have
or
fact checking already.
Oh, great.
Most of the murders happened around Cabot Cove. And
that's her town.
There's been research said that if Murder, She Wrote were real, Cabot Cove would top the crime statistics in several categories.
That's the urban cities that Donald Trump is talking about. That's where we need to go.
When
we got to start in Cabot
when
Cove.
When he says Chicago, he means Cabot Cove.
Cabot Cove.
Cabot Cove is a suburb of Chicago, the yeah. deadliest suburb.
And it's what's the common thread between all those murders? Angela Lansbury.
Wow.
Just saying.
So she did it all.
Someone should write that.
Oh, yes. That would be a fun movie.
Murder, She Did.
Murder, She Did.
Next to you on the couch, we have on our fan cam, Michael Sugarman. You're here for a crazy episode. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me. Looking forward
Where are you from?
Born and raised here.
Okay. That's not very exciting, though.
Plus members from the beginning, so maybe that counts.
That's way more exciting. Yeah. No, but thank you, local. Love to have you, man. Thank you for the support. All right, guys.
You're a fan?
Yes.
Of the show? And you won a contest?
No, we just have fans when they show up. We have fans just watch.
But you have a box, so what's in the box?
Oh, we'll get
what's
there.
What's in the box?
We'll get there.
And your name is Sugarman?
Yes,
searching for Sugarman.
He said Sugarman as if you were a constant player on the show. He's like, yeah, we got Sugarman over
yeah,
there.
Yeah, I know. Like, yeah, oh, yeah, that's Sugarman.
Yeah, sure, yeah, no pressure to you.
That's Sugarman.
I'm going to call you Sugarman
of this show. Sugarman.
All right, so since you haven't played, we'll remind you again, this is about debate, passion, facts, creativity. That's what we're going here. Do not give in to your answers.
Got it.
Whatever you picked, just own it and fight it until the bell rings. That's when the time will be up, and then we'll deliberate. Any questions before we begin?
I mean, I feel like...
Oh, did we have to prepare speeches?
Yeah.
No, we're all right. Per round, I'll explain it.
All right.
Before we do, though, I have to thank this week's sponsor. Let's find out what's in that box. It's Nature Box.
Whoa, I know Nature Box.
Nature Box, Phil. And we can eat those throughout if anybody wants.
Yeah, nice. I haven't eaten lunch. Throw a Nature Box thing up here.
Throw some snacks. Barbecue twists or zesty nacho curls.
Let's throw them all up.
Zesty nacho curls.
Bring them all up. They make snacks that taste great and better for you, created with high-quality ingredients that are free from artificial colors, sweeteners, you can feel great about snacking under snacks as you can choose from. And you can order as much as you want as often as you want with no minimum purchase. After the show, go to naturebox.com/screenjunkies to get saved 50% off your first order exclusive to Screen Junkies fans. Again, naturebox.com/screenjunkies for 50% off your first order. They're good.
Dorito meets a Cheeto.
Like, it's totally legit.
Doritos and Cheetos are healthier.
These crunchy barbecue twists are legit.
All right.
There we go. But Nature Box, we love you. Thank you for the support. Supporting Screen Junkies, you guys know where to get the discount. 50% off your first order. All right, let's do this.
Unfortunately, the orders are $7,000. So you're going to get it for $3,500. But they're good.
They're still a good deal.
You want to fight?
Let him fight.
You start this fight, I'll shoot you.
Heavens. All right, guys.
All right.
This weekend, Kong Skull Island opens. And we wanted to ask this question thematic to that film. This one comes from Zach Smith Michaels. The question is, can you please improve a film by adding King Kong? So take any movie that's already existed and tell me how you would make it better by adding King Kong. So, Paul, you're up first. Kumail, you'll be in second. Spence will be third. But opening arguments first. Go ahead, Paul. What's your choice?
King Kong is one of film's most glorious beasts. Is he angry? We don't know. He's just doing his job. Now, there's another bunch of glorious beasts that also are just doing their job. And they are the team of Fast and Furious. The Rock, the D's, Tyrese. What if we dropped King Kong into Fast and Furious 5, the one where they steal the safe, the best one? And
wow, you're going with the best one.
I think it's the best one. Because I think, how could you make it better? Add King Kong. And I'm going to say this. Just imagine, we saw a fight between Vin Diesel and The Rock. That was pretty electric. But what about The Rock versus King Kong? I don't know who's going to go. I would love to see The Rock just haul off and punch King Kong in the face. Get those oily muscles just up there. Maybe that oil gets in King Kong's fur. Maybe that starts to get a little bit. I don't know. I think that that's a fun battle. Driving a car into King Kong crushing their cars, then they team up with King Kong, and then what I'm saying is, it starts at 5, but then he's in the franchise now, just like Jason Statham, just like The Rock.
I see.
King Kong now, in my version, comes in 6, 7, 8. King Kong is part of the franchise.
Like the introduction of Rockin' Five.
Yes, and he's the one who will then kill, he will kill Charlize Theron in the new one. That's, spoiler alert.
Wow. All right, so big plan with that. Not just one movie. Ballsy choice there.
Wow.
Yeah.
Kumail, what are you picking?
Can I attack his choice? Or do
yeah,
just
tell us yours,
him?
And then we'll go back and have a free-for-all.
Oh, I think Manchester by the Sea, because that's a movie about people not crying when they should be fucking crying. And if he shows up, you'll be crying, and I think everyone will just feel a lot better and a lot less guilty about the things that happened. I don't know if people have seen this movie or not, but I saw King Kong yesterday. It was really great.
Really?
Yeah, really great. But I just think those New England buttoned-up dudes who can't express their emotions need to come up against something ferocious and fucking cry for the first time in
their
life.
You think that... Well, we'll get it. We'll talk about it. Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
Let's hear what Spencer's pick, and then we'll go for it.
Let me briefly talk about a shitty movie that needs King Kong to make it better. You guys picked two good movies and added King Kong to it. I'm adding King Kong to Jurassic Park 2, The Lost World.
Ooh.
Clearly everyone wants to see King Kong fight dinosaurs. I assume he does it in the new one. Does he fight a dinosaur?
No spoilers.
He does in all the other ones. Everyone wants to see King Kong face off against a T-Rex. So I'm giving King Kong to Steven Spielberg, letting him make a movie of T-Rexes fighting King Kong. Mm-hmm. And I'm bumping up a film that had such a boring, just stupid plot with Julianne Moore and what's his name? Jeff Goldblum, and replacing Julianne Moore's character with King Kong.
Don't forget about Vince Vaughn.
Yeah, and Vince Vaughn. So Jeff Goldblum's ex is played by King Kong. They arrive to the island. There's fireworks. King Kong is...
So your movie has straight up bestiality in it.
Well, implied. It was
implied?
In the past. It was in the past.
That's his ex-wife. And if it's in the past, that means it's still...
I'm so sorry.
We gotta wait.
I'm so sorry, Spencer. And then you have that the finale that seems so out of place where it was just the T-Rex wandering around San Diego is now a showdown between T-Rex and King Kong.
All right.
In San Diego.
Yeah.
Okay, great. All right, now you guys can fight.
First of all, I liked that movie a little bit better when it was done by Peter Jackson, right?
Boom!
Yeah. Bam!
What movie?
King Kong.
King Kong. He already fought the T-Rex.
Yeah.
We've seen King Kong fight T-Rexes. Why do we want to see it again? And I don't want to think about Vince Vaughn fucking a giant ape. I'm
Jeff
sorry.
Goldblum.
Whatever. I don't want to see any
I don't want to see it either because you know what? I look, I'm all for whatever you want to do.
Whatever your thing
But I don't want to see that King Kong dick going around with a human. Because then we're talking about, well, look, how are we thinking that King Kong is actually gratified by this? I don't think so.
I think there's truly no way. Either King Kong is receiving or providing.
If he's receiving, the whole body could go into King Kong.
Yeah, and he would barely know.
I'll say this. There's no man, woman, or ape that Jeff Goldblum couldn't satisfy. I think this passes the believability test.
That's actually a good point.
I agree with... Okay, here's what
and I... We're all in agreement on that.
I know we're not.
I agree with
Second point of order, King Kong must have a tiny genitalia because otherwise we'd be able to see it. We've never seen King Kong's dick.
He's got a big bush. He's got a very big bush.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big is King Kong's penis?
Look up
and
King,
how big is the bush?
Look up King Kong dong.
King Kong.
It should be. If you type in King Kong and D, it'll autofill to dong.
No. And actually, I own King Kong dong as a website. And
King Kong
has
dong
some weird
dot,
shit on it.
Dot gov.
Admittedly. But yes. But
so big, warned, okay. The possibilities are fascinating. I want to take issue with Manchester by the Sea.
Okay.
I mean, why would you throw King Kong into the middle of the most non-reactive movie of all time?
To get a reaction from them!
You wouldn't, though. Casey Affleck would be like, oh, I should... Where'd I leave my vape? He'd just stare at it.
That would be fun to see, too. I'd like to see that as well.
Monster movies are all about people screaming, going, oh, no! And Casey Affleck does not do that.
They all have their heads up their own ass in Manchester, brother. They're all worried about their own feelings. That King Kong could walk in and out of a convenience store and they wouldn't even give him a second look.
Yeah, you know what? King Kong will murder The Rock so easily. He will crush it.
Yes! Here's the other thing I just realized. I mean, look.
He takes out helicopters, choppers.
Yeah,
I watched
but also, you gotta understand, like a beast like King Kong would respect a human like The Rock. Like, whoa. What's up
King
here?
Kong. You're overshadowing The Rock. You got to give The Rock his movie to shine. Then maybe if you had King Kong later, fine. But
all right,
you just stepped on The Rock's intro.
Yeah.
He has a partner. He's got a partner. Not Ronda Rousey, is it? Who's the girl?
No, it's yeah, that other girl who is like the blah, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Gina.
No, it's another girl who is like, kind of looks a little bit like my wife because people send us pictures all the time. They go, oh, they look alike. And they have similar cheekbones. Here's the thing. You know my wife, that it would be good for you to look up. I agree. But how cool would it be? It was like, we got to call him backup. And then you see The Rock. Boom. I'm going to take down these Fast and Furious guys. And then he's like, get in here, Kong. And then another door opens, a bigger door, like a big Jurassic Park door. It's like, boom.
Yeah, Jurassic Park door, exactly. That'd be cool to get King Kong.
A big Manchester by the Sea door.
Let me just talk to you about your theory. I think I'm going to blow out his theory right away and go, Steven Spielberg directed Jurassic Park 2 by video monitor while he was prepping Schindler's List. That was not a Spielberg movie.
You might have been more into it if you had the rights to King Kong.
You can't make those two movies at the same time. Very different headspaces.
And that's why I think that Jurassic Park 2 is not as good as Jurassic Park 1, because he was literally directing by a video monitor. Like, the most climactic scene when the trailer is going off the side of the cliff.
I know, it was a shitty movie. I'm trying to improve it. But the question is, what improves the movie with King Kong?
But you're still, Steven Spielberg is prepping Schindler's List, unless you're creating a world in which Schindler's List does not exist, and then I say to you, anti-Semite!
Oh, dude!
Anti-Semite!
Not right now.
Certain.
I will say, you will not be able to find one person who will say that Manchester by the Sea would not be improved by the addition.
I think it would only make that movie less boring.
You're
like, oh, cool.
But the sequence when you get is this a spoiler? The burrito bags of the kids?
You know, here's the thing. I have not seen Manchester by the Sea, but I understand, I guess, what it's about. I didn't know about the burrito bag.
That's real.
Chipotle children.
That's a big spoiler.
Oh, no. All right. I'm going to erase it from my memory.
It's an important lesson in fire safety.
Is this fully live? Are they going to hate me for spoilers?
Well,
they're
going to hate
me. No, it's been out.
Just be like, there are certain people that are in a part of the movie, and then they're not in the movie, and you're like, I wonder what happened.
All I'm talking about is Fast and Furious is a movie about bigger, better, cooler, right? King Kong as the partner of The Rock. I'm just talking about that's a partnership that I want to see. We don't even remember that guy's name.
Right, I'm using that as your closing. Go ahead, Camille, the closer.
We don't remember her name.
My closer?
Yeah, to close up.
I just think, you know, we've seen King Kong fight before, but we've never seen King Kong just like have a talk with a sad man.
No. This is a different pitch. It's a different pitch. Now you're saying he's a part of the emotional
journey.
I want
to see King Kong sad.
I thought you said he's like running around there.
No. He's hanging out. He's like,
you
want to
see people scared.
I feel like you're
going
to get a bunch of racist stuff happening to you. South Boston, a very big.
So he's there to have a sad conversation. Okay, that's all right. So I understand your final pitch. Spencer, last words?
I mean, you already have a big mumbling, incoherent giant guy in the movie, and his name is Vin Diesel. You don't need two Vin Diesels.
But this one's got more hair.
Franchise. You didn't even make King Kong drive a car. How can you not give King Kong a car?
You didn't hear my whole pitch. He has cars on his hands and his feet like Voltron.
Okay. I like that.
And he can basically roller skate on it and get down like that. You know, it'd be great.
That's You're making a mockery
Spencer
of
just
King
gave
Kong.
In, too. That's hard to deny. I think Paul gave the most fun example there. And he also got you because we did see King Kong fight a T-Rex in King Kong.
People want it more.
Camille, you got a little stuck on which version are we doing? Are they scared or are they just crying together?
It's a lot of different.
By the way, you would have sold me on the more King Kong emotionally just being in the police precinct with them.
Yeah, he gets the gun from his hand.
But good first round. Paul, I'm going to give you the point before I go to the fact. Dan, go ahead. Anything to clean up? Sugarman, Dan.
Julianne Moore actually plays Jeff Goldblum's girlfriend in Lost World, not his ex-wife. So that's who King Kong would be playing in Spencer's
Wow, that's
Spencer's
already a
And
huge,
I would never want to cut out Julianne Moore from that.
Huge mistake.
Elsa Pataky plays Elena, who's The Rock's partner
the
in Fast Five. As to the size of King Kong's genitalia, I will say this. Number one, if King Kong is portrayed as a gorilla, they traditionally have somewhat small genitalia. Number two, the genitals are not visible in any of the King Kong movies, which, if you're assuming this is an actual ape, would mean that it's probably true that King Kong is doable.
But I gotta say, whenever I see an ape, like, in out, you know, and if I'm watching Earth 2 or something like that, I'm not seeing a lot of, you know, gorilla dick in that. You know, right? I mean...
Well, because he says gorillas have small dicks.
Small dicks. Comparatively.
So the bush is big.
Comparatively to their overall size.
But King Kong being as huge as he is, and if he is a gorilla, even if it's a small dick for
giant
how big
for
he is, that's still way big for
him. Like it stretches credibility that you would not have seen.
It's like a Prius-sized dick. Based on the size of King Kong, it's at
depending
least a Prius.
Depending how big the Kong, there's several scaled Kongs.
I can only speak from a factual basis here.
There are different kinds of Priuses.
On this upscale, he might be a larger size genitalia. Yes.
Perhaps,
okay, large.
But still in proportionality to the body.
I love that we made you look that
way. This is my job. This is what they pay me to do.
Did you see a picture of a gorilla?
No, I didn't go that far. Come on.
As Goldblum would say, life finds a way.
Life finds a way. All right, round two. This comes in from a tweet by Joshua Pleb.
And he says that in Annie Hall, right? Life finds a way.
Life finds a way. What we have is a dead shark.
Jurassic Park 2, by the way, won the fan poll. 50% voted for King Kong to be added to Jurassic Park 2.
Really?
Yeah. Thanks, fans.
Yeah.
All right. There you go, Spencer. Some validation.
We've
there
seen
go
Kong
we've
fight.
We've seen it.
That's
awesome.
We've already
the,
seen
cracks
it.
Cracks
and we're going to get Godzilla versus King Kong. People
they do it again in a new one. He cracks another mouth.
Would you say, I mean, you're you know, the only one who's seen King Kong at this point.
I saw
is it. Is it the best version? Because I feel like they've tried to do Godzilla.
The original is still the best.
Really?
The original back
King
in the
Kong
day?
Yeah.
The one with the one there, the World Trade Center when they're on top of
this
that one.
This one, well, go ahead. What were you going to say?
I thought that first one is awesome. It kind of actually feels like a roller coaster, like sort of design. You could tell, like, you can imagine, like, people in hats having their minds blown on, you know, back in the 30s or whenever that was from. But I thought this new one was pretty great. I really liked it.
I liked King Kong. I didn't love the people.
John C. Reilly's amazing.
Yeah, he's.
I thought
good.
It was. Well, I will just say, not knowing anything of it, I thought it was a really interesting choice to set it in the 70s. I thought that was a cool choice.
There's a lot of Tom Hiddleston and Brie Larson doing this.
Interesting.
Just standing.
What are they doing?
Staring. They're staring.
Well, you gotta stare. You gotta stare.
You, by the way, transformed into Tom Hiddleston.
I thought it was Brie Larson. I thought I was seeing it.
All right, round two. This one comes in from Joshua Plebe. This is just random because it's a big topic and you guys picked three different movies, so let's go for it. Best James Cameron movie. Kumail, you're first. What did you pick?
I'm going to go with Titanic here, guys. I know that that's a very, very unpopular choice. It's fun to make fun of it and to laugh at people crying. But that's, first of all, sheer length. It's a very long movie. You've got that. You've got a great Celine Dion soundtrack. You've got...
Well, it's not a soundtrack. It's a song.
She has a couple songs on there, doesn't
she? I think it's only over
but
the credits.
But that music shows up a lot.
It's a
running theme. It's got stuff from the present. It's got stuff from the past. It's got Billy Zane in a wig.
You're also pulling the Bill Paxton card right now. We're all remembering him.
Yeah,
and, you know,
yeah, totally. He's great in that movie. I forget the name of the old lady, but she's great in that movie.
I feel her name is Esmeralda.
I mean, when you first saw that movie, you were moved. And now it's become like fun to make fun of it. But I think it's a very... and those special effects, like when the ship's breaking and the scale of it. If you're gonna for like a romantic movie, a lot of special effects. I'll take a rom-com with a ton of special effects, you know.
All right, let's hear Spencer. What are you picking?
It's Terminator 2 Judgment Day. I mean, you're talking score. What's more iconic than
I'll tell you what it is. It's My Heart Will Go On.
We don't want to listen to that again.
I cannot sing.
This is as good as my Hiddleston, yeah.
it appeared like you didn't even know the melody of My Heart Will Go On.
I am doing that.
Tuning a ukulele?
That's
just bad to be pronouncing your name.
I don't think the lyric My Heart Will Go On is actually even in it.
Yes, it is.
It is?
She says, My Heart Will Go On.
It's not the chorus.
She does say it, yes.
My Heart Will Go On. Okay, Terminator 2 Judgment Day. It's the best action movie, one of the best action movies ever made. It's got amazing special effects. It's got heart, it's got comedy, it's got violence, but you could still show it to your kids. It's a perfect, complete movie.
Oh, yeah, you can show it to your kids when the guy gets the milk carton fucking
stabbed through his eyes. Yeah,
real family-friendly film. Sell it on family-friendly.
They sold toys of Arnold Schwarzenegger. This is for kids. It was awesome. I have more to say about it, but I just think...
All right, let's hear what Paul picked.
We can all agree... Avatar, no. James Cameron, obviously an amazing filmmaker, but I think his masterstroke was taking the film Alien and making Aliens. He took source material, redefined it. Terminator 2 is great, but it's just a sequel with better effects. He's already created that world. Titanic, an amazing story, but this is the guy at the top of his game going, all right, this is a cool idea. How do we reconfigure it, make a sequel that is arguably one of the best sequels ever made, right? You could argue that this is definitively a sequel that not only is a great sequel, but stands on its own feet as an independent movie. You don't have to see any other of the films. And to that point, every movie that he has made, or every Alien movie, has never been as good. So it's not an easy feat to make an engaging Alien movie with amazing characters. You get everything that has now been, like, that we accept as normal came out of that movie. The badass, like, Latina, the, you know, the kind of all that, you know, that, you know, like, I feel like that he created that.
So racist.
Vasquez.
What?
Vasquez is the first badass Latina. How about Zorro?
Well, no. I feel like he, like, created that Michelle Rodriguez type of character.
Dude, not only is it not the best James Cameron movie, it's not even the best Alien movie. Alien is way better than Aliens. Aliens is so fucking long. It's like a 2-hour 40.
You just ran on the long.
Yeah, I know, but
ran on the thing about that game.
Yeah, but that was Titanic.
By his own admission, I'm the winner.
He ruined it by coming up with the sequel thing of, like, more is better. Like, now every sequel has more of them. The first one has one alien. It's very simple. It's very scary. Two, there's ton of aliens, ton of machine guns. It's all over the place.
Oh my God, flamethrowers! Look, that created a whole level of video games. Like, we wouldn't have
had flamethrowers before that.
Not in the way that you would put in a video game.
We wouldn't have Halo.
Is that the criteria for putting
things
in a video game?
I agree with that.
You're saying there would be no Halo if it wasn't for aliens.
Yep.
You might have a point there, because they're space marines.
I think that the idea of space marines, I think the idea of, like, the badass fucking lady marine, I think
these
all
are
that
all
stuff,
ideas
think,
that Ridley Scott came up with in Alien.
Oh no, but
really?
Alien? Yes. No. Alien is not marine. Alien is cool because it's normal people, factory
cargo ship. People.
It's cargo people
so
versus
thank you.
Alien.
You're wrong too.
Which to me is way more interesting than marines fighting aliens. That makes sense. But people who aren't
to your point, then you would love the end when Sigourney Weaver goes back to her cargo ship ways and uses the cargo thing to defeat the alien. It wasn't the Marines who win, it's the cargo lady who wins.
Yeah, but she's
the best Paul Reiser performance ever.
All right, hold on. Aliens is a dry run, is James Cameron's dry run for Terminator 2. Everything Aliens has, Terminator 2 has, but better. You have a better...
Does it have aliens?
Oh yeah, it's got Edward
Furlong. Edward Furlong is a better Newt. Edward Furlong
what?
Is a way
no!
better Newt. Yes! He listens to Guns N' Roses, he's got a cool bandana.
Put them pound for pound. Edward Furlong is...
Eddie Furlong is much better than
Newt. He actually weighs less than Newt, but I will tell you the number.
Even today.
Even, yeah.
Sarah Connor is way better than Ripley in that movie.
No!
In that movie,
that
yes.
Is
Sarah, T2 Sarah Connor
That's
is
insane.
Better. Not Aliens or, Ripley, but Aliens
right.
Ripley.
No, I think that people talk about Ripley as an iconic character they want to see more of. I don't think anyone goes like, I want to see more Linda Hamilton's character.
Hell yeah, they do. She had the Sarah Connor Chronicles. She had a whole TV show about her.
Not
it
Linda
was so
Hamilton,
successful
though.
It ran almost a full season.
Yes.
And it wasn't
more.
Linda Hamilton.
It almost
Linda
made
Hamilton.
The double digits episode.
Okay, what about people Alien was it Resurrection where they had like robot Ripley that was god awful?
But that's
what
I'm talking about.
But
I will say it's not even the best Alien movie, and I think most people will agree with me. I think most people
are not making nearly enough fun of Titanic here. Titanic is 340
yeah,
hours long.
You can't make fun of it.
Here's
of it.
The thing about 400 Titanic. Hours long.
Which
James
is the
Cameron
best
gets,
Oscar for best
Here's
movie.
The thing. You take out that ship breaking, that's a boring movie of a dude sketching a girl
oh,
while she's
maybe
moving.
Gives her scabies.
No,
yeah, take out the boat. Take out the boat. Take out
it's
that boat.
It's moving.
This my is, issue with Cameron.
So you're saying if you take out Titanic from Titanic, you don't have a movie?
But the boat is only the last 20 minutes.
How about Aliens without Aliens, dude?
I still think you got the camaraderie. I think you got Paul Reiser, I think you got Bill Paxton, I think you got... Yeah,
that makes a great movie.
I would love to see those Marines
just
hanging out.
Just
how about the
robot?
Don't take out bum, 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 bum. All the kids who lost their fingers because of that movie. What if they... No one crashed a boat after Titanic.
No one ever
killed their
a
father
true,
with a
that's
knife
true.
To the head.
But no, what was I gonna say about Titanic? Take Leo out of Titanic. Put like Leo's value over replacement actor is so high, and that's not James Cameron's doing. If you just have a generic Tiger Beat hunk in Leo's place, no one No one watches that. Leo is the face that launched 1,000 puberties, 1,000,000 puberties.
Yes, wait, you're so making that point for me. Yeah. Or you're helping me.
No, I'm just saying that just because it's Leo that elevates that movie, it's not James Cameron.
But the movie, no, I said the best James Cameron movie, not the best.
Look, I'm going to argue, I will get on your side and say that Billy Zane never gave a better performance than in Titanic.
Not
right?
even in Phantom.
No, I agree.
Zoolander. And Phantom's great.
He's good in Zoolander too. But here's the thing. I think that Titanic, and this is the way I feel about all of a lot of Cameron's movies, are movies that kind of exist in the moment. Like Titanic, if made now, would not be as good. I think Avatar blew my mind when I saw it, but I don't want to go back and revisit it. Aliens, T2, yes, 100%. But I feel like Titanic is a movie I don't ever want to revisit. I'm not like, oh, let me pop that in. Do you ever pop it in?
No, but I remember it. I pop in
Aliens
so well.
I pop in Aliens and I skip forward an hour when something actually happens.
Well, good. I'm glad you put it in.
Yeah, I will watch T2 start to finish any day of the week.
I tried watching Aliens a year ago, and I succeeded, but like I fell asleep. I had multiple meals.
You're making this multiple. The movie is barely 2 hours. You may watch the extended director's cut edition.
Also,
that's your fault.
In respect to Titanic, I want to take you guys forward 30, 40 years when we're all older and going to the cinema, and there's someone who uses 9/11 as the backdrop for a love story.
Are you saying Titanic was their 9/11?
That was their 9/11.
It wasn't even the 9/11.
The unsinkable ship.
For the people who died on the ship.
Just imagine being a Titanic survivor and watching them use it to, you know, jerk off Leo over.
Yeah!
By
the way, this is a crazy equivalency you're going for. Even the people who died on the Titanic were like, 9/11 is going to be much worse when it happens. This is nothing.
I do feel like James Cameron.
Even their family is
looking
like,
at historical tragedy for romance.
To me, that's all I'm going to say to you.
It was hardly a historical tragedy. It was like a fun thing that happened.
It really was. It was like the Zeppelin blowing up.
It really was great.
But T2, let's attack T2 for a second. T2 is, I think, a fine movie, but you've already been introduced to all the characters, all the themes, the whole idea in
T1.
Not
T-1000.
Not the T-1000. That's the only new thing. But I mean, truthfully, it's like, well,
that's an amazing new thing. That CGI still looks good.
One new thing in a sequel. It's like, we are like, Isaac, give the idea to the first idea.
Talk about new things. Sarah Connor went from being the waitress in Terminator 1, and now she's like the resistance leader with all the guns and stuff like that. It was an awesome jump forward for the character. And then you talking about like, oh, you cried tears at Titanic. It's emotional. No one cried more than all of us the first time we saw the thumb going up as it was lowering into the lava.
What about,
that is a heartbreaking
But what about
moment.
This? It is where that is, or Titanic has given us the song that we all hate, My Heart Will Go On. That has given us every bad Arnold Schwarzenegger, hasta la vista, baby.
That's not his fault.
It is.
And well, then fine.
It.
Titanic gave us Pearl Harbor. Like, that's worse
what
than that.
What do you mean? What does that mean?
Like, people trying to take historical tragedy and make
I feel like
a...
you're really overreaching with Titanic as historical tragedy. I don't think
it's... I meant the Ben Affleck movie.
Yeah, I know.
All right, fine.
It didn't define, like, I guess there wasn't even
all right, before Pearl Harbor, the thing people were most upset about was the Titanic.
Let's go through final... I want to know
why... By the way, Titanic was like a magician who has like a simple card trick who makes you watch a half hour explanation to go like, was that your card? And you're like, yeah, couldn't you have just done that earlier? It's like, break that boat.
Just break the boat.
You gotta know all the people
on it.
Gotta build
up that romance.
Why doesn't she give the necklace to her descendants so they can retire comfortably? She just throws it into the water. That's a dick move.
Because it's poetic.
All right, final thoughts really quick. I want to know why yours, for you two specifically, why is yours the better sequel over the other one?
Okay.
And then I want to know why yours is better than both of those sequels. So Spencer, go ahead first.
Mine's a better sequel because it builds on something that James Cameron created. He didn't inherit the character of Ripley and the Xenomorphs from another director. That's all Ridley Scott's doing. So he took something that he created and he twisted it in a new, awesome way that took advantage of everything that was around at the time of the CGI, of Arnold Schwarzenegger, of Linda Hamilton's performance, of Guns N' Roses. He took everything that he could and just made it better, whereas Aliens is just standing on the shoulders of giants.
Aliens took arguably a drama, right? Like, it's all these guys in a ship. It's a hunted movie.
Are you saying Alien?
Oh, sorry, Alien. Yes, Alien.
Was it drama?
It's a horror movie.
It's a horror movie, but I feel like it wasn't an action movie. I think it's Jaws in space, but on a much smaller scale. I think it plays more like a great horror, like, I think there's horror dramas, right? He redefined, he changed genre, created a new batch of characters that you love, that people have tried to make as interesting as they were, but failed continually, right? They brought him to other movies, they couldn't do it. He, talking about, like, taking Linda Hamilton and making her badass, he took Sigourney Weaver, transferred her character, gave her all this kind of pathos because she didn't get saved. She was up there forever. Her whole life has gone behind her. Her kid's now dead. You know, she, and put more stakes to the whole movie. It may be long, but it also, I think, arguably shows you how you should approach a thing. Kind of like Jordan Vogt Roberts. Like, yeah, people have done King Kong. He did it differently and better. The same way Christopher Nolan. He led the way for people redefining a movie and making it their own. No one can make Aliens 2, and I say that because of Aliens 3 and 4.
And Alien vs. Predator.
Correct.
Yes.
Kumail, go ahead. Why is, so after those two, why is Titanic better than that?
I will say that with neither of you, they're not even the best movies in that franchise. I will say Alien is so much better
than
Aliens.
You like Terminator Genesis?
Huh?
Terminator Genesis.
Rise of the Machines. That's my...
Oh, good for you.
That's Salvation. Oh.
See, there's so many. Alien, I think, is a much more cohesive movie. Aliens, to me, is just loud and just so much is happening. So nothing means anything. Titanic is great because it's a beautiful love story. He took the greatest historical tragedy of all time, say it with me, the Titanic sinking, and he put a human face to it. And there's a commentary about the people upstairs and the people downstairs.
Oh,
and
what a heavy just, commentary. The rich people up there.
It's my turn to talk. Plus, it's just fun being on a ship, you know? You get to be on a ship.
I think you started off really strong. Now, it's fun being on a ship.
Moving ahead. The necklace is worth so much money, and it's all about the present. It's the past. Oh, the pictures at the end when she's done all the things that she had never done. But she goes to riding a horse and all that.
She's lovely riding a horse.
All I say is that every one of these movies, think about the what horse. They spawned.
Wow. I tried to get some little out there. I don't know if it helped. Dan, while I'm thinking, go ahead. Tell us anything.
There's a lot to go over here. Let's see. The Titanic soundtrack was orchestral, except for My Heart Will Go On, which does have the line, My Heart Will Go On, in it. It has motifs from the score in it. So it's a hybrid of the score and the Celine Dion vocals.
Thank you, dude.
Aliens has two versions. The theatrical version is 2 hours and 17 minutes long.
So long.
The director's cut is 2 hours and 34 minutes.
How long is Titanic?
Long. Titanic is, I believe, 3 hours and 415 minutes.
Oh, that's not true. There's no way Titanic is 3 hours and 15 minutes.
That's from memory.
It feels it's
over 3 hours.
It doesn't feel like a minute over 2.5 hours.
You haven't seen it since he's on the theater. That's the Avatar.
Titanic
effect.
Is 3 hours and 14 minutes long.
Yep.
Yes. Oh my God. Bang for the buck.
An hour less. An hour less.
For the buck.
Terminator, the Sarah Connor Chronicles ran for technically a season and a half, 31 episodes, uh-huh. 9 episodes, and then 22. And Spencer, regarding your 9/11 point, as Mario Kassler and a few other people on Twitter pointed out, there's a movie called Remember Me that you might want to check out as far as the romance to disaster.
Oh, what about this?
Is that a Robert Pattinson
movie that has a really weird ending?
Yeah. But the 9/11 is a reveal in that movie.
It is.
So that's
it is.
A big
it's not. It's not the quote unquote historical backdrop. And I'll spoil the Robert Pattinson movie. I don't care.
How about World Trade Center? I think Nicolas Cage makes love to somebody in that movie.
Matt, I've got the Twitter poll, which is pretty. It's a two horse race, but there's a pretty clear
winner.
Let
me guess.
You know.
Not Titanic.
Yeah, you actually. Fight. I was with you, Kumail, and then when you started talking about it's fun to be on a ship.
It's fun to be on a ship.
So it did come down between Paul and Spencer there.
How long has that food been on there? It's great.
Yeah, pretty good.
That food's been on there for a while.
You're eating.
Is there any more water?
Yes, we'll get you water. We have a pitcher. Based on those arguments, though, it did come. Spencer got some good moments there explaining how it did twist and made his own creations better. And then you really did make a point, Paul, of how he was able to take someone else's vision and make it better. At the end of the day, based on the notes, I think it was just a slight edge to Paul.
Based
on the points I made here. So, plus for creating the badass Latina.
There were never badass heroines.
Yeah, there's so much stuff you said. Anyway, I got to give Paul the point.
Thank you.
I like that.
What was the poll?
His
what
reasoning the poll? For giving you the point was You said so many things.
The poll currently stands. I'm like Trump. 46% back T2 Judgment Day, 31% Aliens, and 23% for Titanic.
23 is higher than I thought.
Yeah, that's a higher thing.
Yeah, I think it was a tougher to make someone else's creation better and then prove I do think that no one else has done it since was what really stood with
me. I will argue that Alien is better than Aliens.
Wait, 100%. I think right? of them as simply separate films. And that was one of the things I do believe that Alien does a good job at, being a sequel that you don't have to have seen.
You don't need to watch Terminator like T2, though.
Oh, yes, you do. No. To see all the things that you just talked about and see Sarah Connor's
twist.
It makes
it better.
It does. It's a whole story.
You probably do, but it makes
didn't
it better.
Need sequels.
Very
efficient. Right. 3 hours and 15 minutes.
Round
told
three.
Full story.
Right. In honor of Logan, which is amazing. Did we all see Logan?
Did not yeah. see Logan.
Oh, it's really good. Check it's it good. Out. We want to ask, what actor / superhero should return for a final film where they're old? Now, Hugh Jackman has gone on record saying this is his last time. He's older, playing the older character. So which one do we want to see next? Which superhero are we bringing out and seeing retire? Spencer, you're up first. And we have some visual aids for each other.
So it's got to be a superhero.
Yes.
Yeah, Adam West Batman. We
Let's
could do this.
It. Let's
we,
see it.
Yeah, is there a visual aid? I didn't know. Okay, wait, yeah, no. sure.
Where that is Adam West.
Great. Where are the good ones, Max?
Definitely.
Yes. Oh, wow. Much better. That is awesome.
Thanks to James Ruiz, our box office artist.
Clearly, you can do this movie today, right now, because that's what you're getting. You know, Logan, despite all the gore and the carnage, it was about repressed feelings.
This no spoilers of Logan,
like Manchester
please.
By the Sea.
Like Manchester by the Sea.
Which would have been great
Kong,
to have
Dawn of
Kong
Justice.
In there.
Yeah. this was a movie that was about a man who's holding on to all these feelings for so long, he could only express it through rage. Who's more repressed than Batman? So I want to see old Batman.
Repressed? Yeah, like the anger is front and center with Batman.
No, but as Bruce Wayne, let's put it that way. As okay. Bruce Wayne, he's just holding so much in, and he's a
senior. Well, he lets it out at night when he's Batman.
Well, he's a senior now. He's okay. not. He hasn't been Batman for a
okay,
while.
Okay, got it.
And he's ready to lay it all out there. Adam West is ready to come clean. He's Batman. He's gay. He and Burt
Ward.
Wait,
I'm sorry, what?
Are living together.
Wow.
This is all about. Do you guys see that movie Beginners?
Yeah, love yes. Beginners.
Yeah, Amy imagine McKellen. That with Batman.
Okay.
This is about like the end of life.
Batginners?
Batginners. Yeah. This is Batginners. Thank you. You know, you can have flashbacks to the earlier moments, and maybe you can work in some of the other Batman and Joker actors. You bring back Bale. You bring.
But
back
I want to talk about your vision for it. Is it 60s Batman? Like, is he in that same costume?
No, he's a. Is he like
I mean, well, that was an artist rendering.
Is he in a fucking mech suit?
Artist rendering, yeah.
Yeah, because I mean, I want to see how you Michael. Picture it. You he's, picture him as what?
He's still in the fucking polyester, right?
Yeah, he's still like, in the polyester, but I mean, I guess times. This is present day. We're just imagining that, you know, back in the 60s, he was in the polyester. Today, he's in the iron bat suit, I guess.
Really?
I had nothing to do with that image.
Anybody
I'm gonna
could be
roll
in that.
Yeah.
I could be in that kicking ass.
Yeah.
You so could, yeah, but it's more a spiritual journey. He's done. He's putting down the cape. He's letting down his guard. He's telling.
By the way, that outfit does not have a cape.
Yeah, it's a mech suit.
Well, I didn't do that fucking drawing.
You don't have to get behind that drawing.
It's just an artist rendering.
Your
ahead.
Idea.
Yeah.
Look, we don't need any more. This is controversial. We don't need any more Batman movies. We don't need any Ooh. More Batman stories.
What? There's so many supervillains we haven't gotten through.
We've got enough, okay? We've had enough Batman
when
on the
done
big screen.
Right, you want to see him.
And yeah. But we want to see what would be more emotional than a final send-off to Batman, seeing him finally conquer what was driving him to be Batman in the first place, which is all this repression, all this pent-up rage and attraction to
all
Robin.
All you need is a good actor to do it.
Well, we've got Adam West,
yeah,
who's mature.
Yeah, that's all I'm saying. Yeah,
and like, you will cry so many tears when we finally say goodbye to Batman.
Oh, I'm so old. so angry.
We should be writing this down.
All right, Paul, what are you picking?
I'm going a little bit controversial here because this is an interesting idea, right? Who can come back? A lot of these people who are playing these characters are old. Like, they're like, you know, like we've already seen a lot of people do the old version of this stuff. So I was really thinking about a superhero could benefit from becoming older. And I think of it as Shaquille O'Neal as Steel.
Wait.
That's
on,
Shaquille O'Neal.
Again, go to the better. There it is.
And there he is. All right, so obviously we know Steel is kind of a version of Superman. When Superman died in the comics, one of the versions of him was Steel. So this is an older Shaq. As you see, by the way, I love this. I love this artist rendering. This is exactly how I feel. When Shaq made this movie, he was young, he was cocky, he was making Kazam, he was making Steel.
By the way, he's still cocky.
Well, that's kind of
and
thing.
And arguably but, young.
Yeah.
Is he young?
He's like athletes. But we're old by athlete standards.
But wait, we're not saying that it has to be now. We're saying who
yeah,
wants
to be a little bit later. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, who we want to see come back eventually. I want him to come back with that big white beard. I want him to come, and we all know the Steel story. I mean, we all know it's timeless.
I will say this. I haven't seen Steel because I truly believe not one person on Earth has seen Steel. I don't think anybody's seen that movie.
Steel is a great movie about a junkyard guy in an inner city town who decides to take matters into his own hands by creating his own junkyard tools, aided by Richard Roundtree. Who builds amazing motorcycles and builds an amazing suit for him where he's able to do amazing feats of strength. Now, just by seeing Steel, I should get a point for that, really. I feel like...
It's sort of a job on your show.
No, but yeah. I do feel... You're right.
Did you do it on your podcast?
We did do it on the podcast, yeah. It was an interesting movie. We did Steel and Kazam back to back.
Oof.
I do think... What I like is, like Adam West, I would like to see Shaq handle a little bit of a heavier acting. A little bit of, it's like an interesting character. Because if you go back and reroute the whole
Nobody
thing.
Nobody shares your enthusiasm for this.
We'll find out in the voter poll.
Yeah, just rip up the floor and go, here's a guy who lives in the inner city. He's seeing terrible things happen all around him. He works in a junkyard and he's like, you know what, goddammit? I'm not a superhero. I'm just a man. I'm kind of like Batman, but I'm going to make my own costume, and I'm going to make things work in my inner city. And he goes out there, and he takes care of business.
But that's the movie Steel. We're talking old Steel.
Yeah, you just repitching Steel.
You're just pitching Steel again.
But as an older man, because you know what? Here's the thing. The violence has gotten worse. The violence has gotten a lot worse. And here's the other thing. He can't move so well in that suit anymore, right?
Right, that's what it needed.
And I think we all feel like one of Arnold Schwarzenegger's best performances was End of Days, where he cries looking at the jewelry box. I think we would love to see Shaquille O'Neal shed a tear for maybe his children who took over the Steel mantle, and now he's got to get back in the business because someone killed his child. Anyway, Steel. Shaq.
All right, well, here, Kumail, go ahead. What's your pick?
I want to see a super old Tobey Maguire coming back to play Spider-Man, because Spider-Man is always about, he's always a kid, he's in school, he's balancing. There he is. He's balancing. Wow. That's Tom Holland. I'll take that, too. I just don't think I'll be alive when he's that old. But... Because it's always like sort of an allegory for puberty. He's shooting white things out of his body. We all know what that is. And it's... you know when you're like around 12 or 13?
Yeah, yeah,
you spit a lot. You wake up in the middle of the night and there's spit all outside of your mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah. Totally. What a strange... What a strange thing just happened. I got a weird visual in my head. Pun intended. Because it's always about him not being able to figure out his school life, crushes on his girls, should he fight crime? Well, what's his responsibility? What should he be doing? Should he be studying? Should he be with his Aunt May? He has the guilt over Uncle Ben. Great to find out. Are you now fucking over Uncle Ben dying? Like, how many times do we have to hear about you fucking crying about Uncle Ben? How many times am I gonna see this guy die?
Right, so we need, all right.
So okay. Now I just want to see, has he balanced those things? How were his grades? Is he with the girl? Or is he still, like, trying to recapture his youth? Is he still trying to save Uncle Ben? I just think,
how old, but they're ignoring the rendering. Spunky. How old is he in your movie?
Super old.
So he still is in school, night classes. You said he had.
He never finished.
How were his grades?
He's trying to do the GED. He's okay. Trying to go back.
Still trying to finish. Okay.
He's trying to finish his high school. He's trying to figure out he's got a girl he's interested in. You know, because high schoolers get.
Wait, so why don't you put him in a nursing home? And then he's in a nursing home, and it kind of has the same elements of a high school. You know, hierarchy.
Great pitch.
What table
great
do you
pitch.
Sit at?
Yeah, now it's the beginning. But
wow, really
cool?
Helping him. Yeah,
well, but cool old guys. But lame old guy.
Now I'm gonna pull the rug out from it and say like this, right? Tobey Maguire, I would argue, Spider-Man 1, pretty good. Spider-Man 2, great.
Great.
Spider-Man 3, awful. Like, went off the cliff, awful. So if you're projecting, as he gets older, he gets worse, think about, like, how he would be.
But that's a weird. Shaq. That's a weird thing. You're making us. Yeah, Shaq
only ages like a fine wine.
Right. Totally.
Older. Yeah. Been around. Had some ups and downs.
So is this? Is it? Yeah, is this
he's been really working on his craft. Doing the NBA after show.
Is
this
sumo rusty or is it stainless steel?
He said it's rusty and it's rusty. Harder to move.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Great. Great superhero. Yeah, hard to move. My guy still has superpowers.
But that's the
job. He can fly around. He can shoot white things. But every now and then it doesn't work. He has to take Viagra to shoot his webbing. Out.
But there's a reason why Spider-Man's always young. It's because his character is a metaphor for that time when we're all shooting webbing and we're struggling with it.
But that's why it's interesting to see, like,
but
as
that's
a
not Spider-Man.
Mural, he is Spider-Man.
Does he get back into it, or is
it's
he
not
like
Spider-Boy.
Always been Spider-Man?
He's been Spider-Man, and then he sort of quit for a little bit, and then now... Actually, you know what? He's been fighting crime the entire time.
Wow.
And juggling, trying to get the GED, trying to
still
get the
still taking
girl.
Pictures?
He's big into pictures, but his
do
eyesight's
people know that, like, yeah, his
stuff.
Like his like he has like bifocals on his
yeah,
like
yeah, he has
eyes.
To like yeah.
You're just describing a set of superpowers. Spider-Man the character is someone who's always in high school. There's a reason
but
why
I'm
that
bringing
young,
something,
at least in the movies.
But I'm bringing something new to it. What you're doing with Batman is what we've already seen. Dark Knight Returns and old
no,
Batman.
I need to Batman finally
can
grow out of
can
Batman,
I go to the, can
which
I go
is
to the judge for a question here? Because sure. I think this is an important clarification for our audience and for us. Are we talking about an older version of the character? Or are we talking about the actor playing him? Because that's a big difference, right? Because obviously there's
both.
A good... There, well,
it's
both.
Sort of both, yeah.
All right.
Because I think they come together.
Interesting.
Yeah.
All
who
right.
would you recast?
Because,
Steel?
I mean, arguably you could say that Batman
yeah,
as an older...
Morgan Freeman?
Hey, maybe Blake Griffin as Steel, huh?
By the way, 100% would be great. Blake Griffin could carry it off. He could do the... He could. I would like to see DeAndre... Actually do it. DeAndre as Steel,
Thespian,
I'm all in.
Yeah.
I'm front row center. I may be the only one, but I'm there. And I, you know, I will finance that movie. But no, I think like Steel is, this is what I'll go back to. The most interesting superhero movies to me are not people who have a special power because they're bitten by a spider or an anger issue. It's a guy coming from a place of, I want to help. It's the arc that Tony Stark makes in Iron Man where he goes, you know what? I used to be this. Now I'm going to do this.
Yeah,
and this
what,
is what Steel is
yeah,
doing.
Yeah, Iron Man does it yeah. so much better. You've described homeless Iron Man.
Yeah.
That's
he's
more
homeless
interesting.
Iron Man.
A Batman
right,
without money
yeah.
And a Tony Stark without money is more interesting. That's a guy doing it. That's
and
a
he
guy
got covered in
he's
junk.
Just, he's just good because characters like, without flaws are so interesting.
He's not, no, he has flaws. His flaws is like he's trying to keep his junkyard open.
That's not a relatable flaw, buddy.
And, yeah, trying to keep your job.
No, yeah, you know,
there's no shortage of trash.
Obama
now,
we're
to use your pitch as you're closing there. Yes. Kumail, what's your okay. pitch? Give me your pitch. Like
I will say, because this is a character, all they're pitching is just heightened versions of the characters that we've seen. We've seen these ticks. We're seeing Spider-Man in a completely different context because he is so defined by his youth and his school days. I want to see what happens with that super hero when he's an old man. Why have we never seen that? We've seen old Batman. Nobody wants to see old Steel.
I mean, I think the people are crying out for it.
But old Spider-Man, I want to know what a really old Peter Parker does. I want to know what his life looks like.
Okay.
By the way, I do want to just add one thing, too. Like, in Steel, when we first see Steel, we're not even getting near Superman. By the time you see my version of Steel, he has now transformed into a known commodity as Superman. Like, he doesn't ever reveal himself to be Superman.
In the movie.
Steel, they
in
never
the
even referenced Superman.
Well, they couldn't
of course,
get,
and that's what I'm saying. In the older version, we're going to finally take that mantle.
They couldn't get the license.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Spencer?
Fast. Yeah. Okay. The gay old Batman. What I.
Oh, right. We forgot that part.
I mean, I think your whole argument is just thrown out the window because it's not a good actor. Not that I can
Well, what I glossed past,
dude.
But I want to focus on is that most of this movie is told in flashback to previous moments in his life that are given a new spin.
So your idea of an old Batman is just seeing young Batman?
He's telling stories about older Batman.
So it's like one of those episodes that when they ran out of money on TV shows where they'd sit around the living room and go, remember that Christmas episode?
Yes, except that it's Christian Bale and it's Michael Keaton in those flashbacks.
We've already seen Lego Batman already did that where they reference specific parts from the different
and
Batman.
It was great. Yeah,
yeah so
it,
why do
but
it again?
Then it keeps going. You see the Joker go through chemo. You see, you
what?
Know, you see Damian die.
Which Joker?
Let's say.
Does he have Obamacare?
Leto.
Is that why?
Let's say
Leto. Death panel. The Joker goes out in front of
death
panels.
Yeah, but finally, it's real life catches up to him, and he's like, why have I been so angry and so wound up for so long? It's time for me to live my life, and that makes you cry, like Logan.
Dan?
Yes.
Well, Adam West and Burt Ward both returned to their roles last year in an animated film, Batman Return of the Caped Crusaders. It was a 60s animated film for the DC animated universe.
Whoa, really?
Yeah. They did.
Well, they actually did a comic book, too, where they used their... Because basically they reached a deal, I think, in the last year or so where they could license their images now. So you can have Burt Ward and Adam West Batman action figures.
There's an
comics.
Animated?
It's called Batman Return of the Caped Crusaders.
It's pretty good.
I believe Lee Merriweather or Julie
Moore everyone's in
came
it.
Back and did Catwoman.
What are the reviews like?
I will check that.
It's a fun. It's very reminiscent of.
Sounds fun.
Of Batman, yeah.
Despite Paul obviously having seen Steel, not many other people saw it.
Yeah, probably people
it grossed $1.7 million off a budget of $16 million.
That's not bad.
In 1997.
It's a movie that's not greedy.
More of that, like
these,
please.
Like these big movies that want to make all this money. What about a movie that you make for a lot of money that's like, I don't need to make money. I just want to make it for
I'm
the art.
I'm cool. I don't want to prove anything.
By the way, it did premiere at the Sundance Film Festival, Steel.
There you go.
There's no way
kind of mistake.
And the Return of the Caped Crusaders, generally good reviews, generally positive reviews.
Yeah, it's fun.
So, yeah, there you go.
You saw it.
I did.
We have the Twitter poll also, there's a favorite on the Twitter poll. Right now,
look, I don't think anyone wants to see Shaq again. I think they sort of pointed you there. You even sort of didn't want to watch the movie the first when you admitted that you were the only saw it.
Look, I'm going to say this. I wasn't happy with my choice.
You literally on your podcast that's called How Did This Get Made? Are pitching a sequel to a movie that you were wondering, how did the first one get made?
I appreciate the commitment.
I had to stick to it. I was like, old Shaq to me may be interesting. I would like to see old Shaq.
So it came down to Spider-Man and Adam West Batman, and you lost me with the going back to see the other Batman. So Kumail gets the point for Spider-Man. You didn't give me much of a pitch, but we haven't seen old Spider-Man, and that's something I would want to see. We see him defined by youth. Let's see what happens in his old age.
I like it.
You get the point.
Yeah.
The internet would give Kumail the point as well. 50% voted for Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man.
I think that Kumail made the best choice because I'm going to say that in thinking of it, it was a hard pick because
Michael Keaton Batman would have been a cool choice.
I'll go that
we
way.
We sort of saw Birdman, which was kind of
true.
I just feel like there has been enough touching on those areas where it's like it's a harder thing.
Are there any other good ones, Dan?
Online?
Yeah.
A lot of people were mentioning Michael Keaton's Batman as one that they would like to see. I lost my Twitter tag.
Oh, well, you tell us later.
I'll tell you later.
All right, let's go to round four. This is fun. We're totally random. We went with it, and you guys picked some good choices. The task here is to pitch a reboot of a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie. So update the plot, who takes on the JCVD role, who directs it. Give us the whole pitch. And, Paul, you're up first. What Jean-Claude Van Damme movie are you remaking?
Okay. In making a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie, you also have to create the atmosphere of a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie. I'm not going for The Dark Knight here. I'm going for taking a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie and making it as fun as the blood sports were, as the time cops were. They all were cut from the same cloth, if you will, right?
Sure.
They're fun, big movies. So I am going with a little scene, but really ripe for reboot movie called Double Impact. Now, if you don't remember what Double Impact was, it's not the one with Dennis Rodman. It is the movie where Jean-Claude Van Damme plays against himself.
Twins.
One's good, one's evil. We haven't seen a good twins movie in a long time. And who is the modern day Jean-Claude Van Damme? Who is the person that is going to really chew up the scenery? Now, Jean-Claude always had the accent thing. What about Vin Diesel, good and evil, right? Twin brothers.
Twin Diesel?
Going at Twin Diesels fighting each other. Now, here's the thing. I know this for a fact. There it is. With the hair. Amazing. Right now.
Did they mock that up or did he have hair in a movie?
No, I mocked that up.
He had hair in that Witch movie where he's the witch hunter?
He also had hair in Find Me Guilty.
Find Me Guilty,
yeah.
Yes.
So here's what I think about it. I would see that movie. If you put Vin Diesel on both of those faces, Vin Diesel the cop hunting down Vin Diesel the villain. And here's the thing I know about Vin Diesel. He has in his contract that he does not lose fights, right? who's going to lose the fight?
These are going to lose fighting forever.
It would be the best fight of
all. In his contract, it's like he doesn't lose fights?
Yes. And now in the Fast and Furious movies, he cannot lose a fight. Neither can The Rock.
That's
and
amazing.
Neither
true,
can.
Yes.
There's like three of them that can't lose fights. Yeah.
Yeah, so who wins in that fight?
That's what I'm saying. Like, I would love to see them go toe-to-toe. And by the way, I'm going to say the other thing about Vin Diesel that I really love is he has yet to really stretch both of those muscles, because you know that he wants the juiciness of playing the bad guy, but his brand can't take that. So he could only get him to play the bad guy by making him the good guy too. That's my pitch. And oh, and the director of it, I am going to say Justin Lin. I'm going to bring back, it's going to bringing back, kind of like making it fun, making it action-packed.
He did Fast Five, right?
He did Fast Five. He did Star Trek, the latest Star Trek.
Which is really good.
I really liked it a lot. It's super really fun. Good. So again, it's a popcorn movie. It's a fun movie. That's my pitch.
All right, Kumail, what are you picking?
I am going with Time Cop, which is my favorite Jean-Claude Van Damme movie because it's got some great time travel stuff in it. I love, you know, just the idea of a time cop is great. And I'm putting Tony Jaa in there because I think he's one of the greatest action heroes around right now. If you guys didn't see the Ong Bak movies, please see them. And the reason I'm doing this is I want to have a set piece in the movie where he has a set piece in Ong Bak where he's sort of running through a market and sort of jumping through things, and it's like a crazy parkour-y chase scene. I want to see that set across different times. So as he's jumping, he's jumping through time.
He parkours through time.
He's parkouring through time in this movie.
Kind of like Prince of Persia in a way, but it's always changed. The background's always changed.
Right, and it goes super, you know, it goes to the future, it goes robots, it goes to the past, it goes dinosaurs. It's like sort of everything. And
so
it's
both robots and dinosaurs in this.
Yeah, but not robot dinosaurs.
Oh, okay.
Robots,
that's for
dinosaurs,
the
everything, and it's directed
and
by
King Kong.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's a King Kong, and it's directed by Jean-Claude Van Damme, because I want him to just tell Tony Jaa, like, I could do it much better when he never
amazing.
Could. Just to see the rivalry that they would have
yet?
On
that's
set.
Interesting.
Yeah. I don't think he's directed, but he... Oh, no, I mean, he may have directed, like, one of the sequels
the
to Bloodsport.
The Quest.
The Quest. Oh, yes. Ooh. Yes, we did that on Good How one. To Discover.
He directed The Quest?
The Quest was
that
just
a lot
remake.
Of sense, actually.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. It's a rough one.
Spencer, what's your pick?
Okay,
it's a boring version of Bloodsport.
Well,
spoiler alert.
Yeah, because Bloodsport's great, so I'm remaking Bloodsport. And I'm doing it differently. This is now an Edgar Wright action comedy starring Nick Frost. This is a.
So, are you taking the character, the side character from Bloodsport, the hillbilly that partners up, like that guy? No, okay, he's the lead.
He is the lead. Simon Pegg is the friend that gets murdered. This is a genre of movie that is ripe for parody, and not in that like scary movie way, but in the way that Edgar Wright does it, where it's loving and it's an homage.
I don't
to
think
these...
Edgar Wright does parodies. I will argue
I
that.
Agree with
I don't
okay,
think
well,
he does
whatever
parodies.
You want to call Shaun of the Dead is a zombie.
I think what Edgar Wright does is like.
Comedy. Horror comedy. It plays with the tropes of zombie movies, as does the other one about aliens. Hot Fuzz plays with Buddy Cop and World's End messes with aliens. Hey, nice, Dan.
Yeah.
Cornetto. So this is
the green one, Spencer.
Yeah, the green one. Yeah. I'm Cornetto Quadrille.
I thought you were going to say Hot Fuzz. Yes.
And this is interesting because this is a style of movie that is not around anymore. The fight movie.
Fallen out of favor is the fight tournament movie.
The
Kumite, yes.
But I am worried. Well,
underground fighting movie.
I'm worried about how Nick Frost gets into this world.
Well, tell us more. You have more to say?
Well, I mean, that's where you get your comedy. This is the guy that hasn't had direction in life. His friend is murdered in this blood sport, and he is now going to train under the son of what's his name? You know, the giant guy that's in it.
That guy.
And he's gonna train him. I mean, you guys never even talked about the splits. How about a Nick Frost learning to do the splits montage?
He's not gonna be able to do it. You can do the splits.
The
I feel
splits
like you're
are
pitching that movie Balls of Fury with like Dan Fogler. Like,
yeah,
I feel
that's
like
what
you're
pitching. That's yeah, right.
It's
that's
like,
what this
it literally is.
We've
like,
seen that.
It was pretty funny.
Yeah.
The foot fist way is closer, but
so you're pitching a movie that kind of feels like the foot fist way.
No,
you've sold me a little bit more on it.
This is Edgar Wright. This is like he brings to it.
But Edgar Wright and
is not foot fist way.
Yeah, exactly. Or Balls of Fury. I'm like,
but it's not a parody movie, is what you're saying.
No, it's set in that genre. Yes.
I think you're putting, I mean, for lack of a better thing, you're putting like a fat guy into a world where he shouldn't belong. Like,
he's gonna he's gonna Chris Pratt by the end of this. We're gonna shoot in reverse order, and he's gonna get abs.
Wow.
So you start shooting this movie and Nick Frost looks like how we know and love him, and by the end you're saying that he is...
He's ripped. Kind of like Tom ripped. like Tom Hanks did in Castaway. They take off a movie, like basically Robert Zemeckis went away, shot What Lies Beneath, then came back so Tom Hanks could lose all that weight.
Yeah, and Edgar Wright is a super underrated action director.
I don't think he's underrated.
In terms of action, at least. Like his... sequences are like actually exciting.
World's End is awesome.
And I think Hot Fuzz. Well,
Scott Pilgrim has amazing action.
But they think of him as a comedy guy. They think of him as like a specific...
He's directing his next movie as a full action movie.
I can't wait. Baby Driver. He's a great choice. And we haven't even talked about your guys' pitches of the... that sounds like a great... Who picked Time Cop?
Me.
Yeah, so like you picked this like fun treadmilling through time sequence. But like why? You're just doing another guy with broken English doing the Time Cop movie again.
I think
man... But there's all kind of languages in the world. I think he should be docked a point for making comments against immigrants. I see what side you're on.
Here's what I'm going to say. Here's what I'm going to say about Bloodsport. Bloodsport is one of those rare films that you can only make because of Jean-Claude Van Damme. It doesn't work when you put somebody else in it.
No, because like, I think so. Mortal Kombat, they've made...
No, they don't work. Not good. Yeah, that wasn't good. The ones that work are the ones where the people are actually very good.
Are you going to say Gymkhata?
I like Gymkhata. Yeah, that's a film.
I mean, but basically, you're pitching, though. But Gymkhata, at least the guy had talent. Edgar, like,
okay,
you're
Karate
saying,
Kid. That's the kid's version.
I don't think you can have a big kung fu movie with a guy who is just not a great, like, kung fu guy. I think at its core, it's not going to be fun to watch, no matter how good you train.
But we're pitching
Nick Frost.
A reboot, and your guys is just a remake. Like, this is an actual different spin
on it.
Wait,
a reboot? Well, wait. A reboot is... So you're saying... In this world, Jean-Claude Van Damme's
reboots
character...
Reboots and remakes are the same thing.
That's not... I don't want to get bogged down in
Okay.
I'm going to say this. I think it's going to be anticlimactic.
I do appreciate how many questions you guys have about my idea.
The reason why you go see a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie, and any of those movies, is for the splits, is for his fighting style. It's the same reason why you see Steven Seagal. The movies are never as good.
Yeah, but Jean-Claude Van Damme's not walking through that door.
Not anymore.
You know what? I would love to see a new Bloodsport with Steven Seagal currently in it and just
that
watch
would
him
be amazing.
Ass kick
just
first.
One, yeah. Just destroy.
Just barely moving.
I once heard a story that they choreographed a giant fight scene for Steven Seagal. And they brought him in. They're going to do this. We're going to do this. We're going to do this. Steven Seagal's like, how about they both come in and I just go like this. They didn't have to get up out of the chair. I'm going to go back to my film for a second and just talk a little bit about Double Impact and why I like it. I would argue, and I don't know if you guys have seen it, but The Return of Xander Cage, the new Triple X movie. Have you guys seen it?
Oh, it's awesome. Yeah.
It's pretty fucking awesome because it's fun. And Vin Diesel knows how to make those 80s action movies again. Like, it's, you know, it's like it's sort of like he's the only one who kind
of... It's awesome, but he needs support. He needs a team or a family. Well, he's got Ruby Rose backing up. He's got Ice Cube backing him
but
up.
But that's what I'm saying.
Ice Cube's in the new
one. Oh, spoiler alert. Yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Both the Triple X's are in it?
Yes. Yeah. And it, well, there's see the first
that's
one starts
X's.
Off.
Well, so sad.
Too many X's.
The first one starts off as only one. The second one's like there's two. Now there's a lot of triple X's.
A lot of X's.
But one of them is a soccer player.
Neymar is one of the triple X's.
But here's the thing,
Neymar, the Brazilian soccer guy, he kicks a napkin holder to a mugger's head. It's the most amazing thing you've ever seen.
I just want to say to your point that he needs support around him. Double support. Why? Because he's got two sets of friends. So think of it like this. The good guy's got his version of Tyrese, his version of Ruby Rose. The bad guy's got his, you know, his Michelle Rodriguez, his Rock. So they're going to have, you're almost getting two Vin Diesel movies for the price of one. It's like, here's Vin Diesel as a bad guy, here's him as a good guy, and guess what? They're fighting each other. So it's like you're creating...
Vin Diesel's not a good... He's not good at fighting in his movies. His action's not good. Tony Jaa is amazing. Have you seen him move?
What? Tell me the plot, though. I don't know the plot. All I know is a parkour through the woods. Bizarre.
You're just doing Time Cop again. But now it's Tony Jaa.
But with different specifics.
I like your idea of Time Cop is ripe for reboot, but
there's
my
issue
is there's
a murder in the past, and they gotta go back and solve the murder.
Does he have to knee an elephant in the face?
I want to see a reboot. I want to see a reboot of Time Cop, but I don't feel like you have pitched me on the... Like, I'm into Tony Jaa, I'm into Time Cop, but why?
Tell me more. Why? Yeah.
Why?
Yeah, what happened? I got the montage scene, but yeah, give me a little bit more.
Well, remind me what happens in the original Time Cop.
He's framed. They're running some kind of stock scam or something for dirty money in the past.
Time Cop is a movie that does not take advantage of time travel that much.
No, it really doesn't.
Yeah, they don't really.
This one will. He is a time cop. He goes through time and he solves different murders. It's sort of like Murder, She Wrote, but through time. It's not just in whatever town she's in. He's in, like, he's sort of, so when the movie starts.
But is it fun?
Oh, it's so
fun. Give me a couple times.
Tony Jaa doesn't seem like I'm going to be laughing with Tony Jaa. Tony Jaa seems like
give me one time moment with Tony Jaa that we're gonna have fun with.
What do you mean?
Give me one moment in time where we take Tony Jaa to any moment in time where we're going to have some fun.
There's a T-Rex murder that's happened in the past.
Well, I guess
there are poachers.
Oh, wait, they murdered the T-Rex.
The poachers are going back in time and killing T-Rexes and selling their teeth as a medicine that certain people believe gives
I gotta go get some popcorn during this.
Very similar to
really great boners. And so he has to go back and catch the
poachers. That's a real popcorn movie. Catching poachers?
So he fights the poachers. I think he's gonna fight the T-Rex.
T-Rex.
Make him fight the dinosaur.
Make it like they get Hitler from back in time and they have to chase Hitler.
Hitler, we've heard that. We haven't seen T-Rex murders. This is new.
Hitler. You want him to fight the T-Rex, not the poacher.
Here's what I tell you.
Yeah.
The movie's actually pro-Hitler. It's a weird little thing you find out at some point. Find out.
All I'm saying is this. Double impact. You're getting everything you like of the cheesy Vin Diesel movies, but you got double of them, and you're keeping the fun. Both of these movies, like Bloodsport, that seems like, yes, I love Edgar Wright, I love Nick Frost, but that doesn't seem like a movie I want to see. I'd be like, ooh, that's a bummer. That's a
final
misstep.
Thought, Spencer.
I do want to see it. I want to see what he does with that genre.
Would you really want to see Edgar Wright directs Nick Frost in Bloodsport? That would be like, if you heard that, I would go like this. If I saw that announced, I'd be like, what happened? Who does he owe money to?
Did you say yes or no, Kumail?
To what?
Did you say Edgar Wright?
Do you want to see that?
I don't.
You just read it on the Slash Film. Would you say like Edgar Wright?
I look at the date because it seems like it's April 1st.
Okay.
I would be super psyched. And if I heard Twin Diesel is going to do stars.
You'd be like, yeah, that makes sense. How much money worldwide is it going to make?
He's not a good martial artist.
Vin Diesel's not good at fighting.
But no. You're mixing peanut butter and peanut butter. It's too much peanut butter.
Guys, if you saw Double Impact, it's much more of a gun movie. It's much more than a John Woo movie thing. It's more Face Off, less Bloodsport. That's where Jean-Claude matured to.
Did you have a last thought, Spencer?
I wish the double one with Dennis Rodman's way better. What?
No, it isn't!
What's the double one, Dennis Rodman?
Double Trouble? Double Team?
Double Team.
I've seen Double Impact. I haven't seen Double Team. Double Team because he's a basketball player.
That was fun. I'd see all three, to be honest. But
Double Dribble.
Yes, Dennis Rodman was in the cinematic masterpiece known as Double Team, 1997.
Wasn't he also in a movie with Dane Cook at one point?
Dennis Rodman?
Dennis Rodman and Dane Cook were in an action movie together.
Dennis Rodman and Rob Schneider were in a movie together too, right? Or no?
I think I have to look at that.
Is Dennis Rodman and Dane Cook coming up with something? Because if I'm right about this, I get a point for just that.
I'm going to be very impressed.
Dane Cook in...
There was
someone.
A Dane Cook action movie that I believe was with Dennis Rodman and the team up.
Yes, it's called Simon Says.
Yes,
Says. From 1999, Dane Cook is second credited. He plays Nick Miranda. Dennis Rodman is Simon, and Dane Cook is Nick Miranda from Simon 1999, Says. Simon Says.
I think that may even be a sequel to his character from Double Dribble or whatever.
Double Team. He's described as a hip Interpol agent attempting to defeat the deadly plans of a crazed army.
I gotta watch that.
Stay tuned for How Did This Get Made? That will be on there.
Isn't Interpol British? Is he doing a British accent?
They're worldwide. They're international. They're
Interpol, but I will say it's not spelled Simon Says, S-A-Y-S.
S-E-Z.
I remember that. You didn't need to tell us that.
Of course, for the folks at home. But not for you. Obviously,
everybody knew when
the era of Limp Bizkit.
The Quest was Jean-Claude Van Damme's directorial debut. Time Cop features three different years, 2004, 1994, and briefly 1929.
Yeah, I see.
And
they didn't even use it.
The Twitter vote is, Andy, I'm going to let this refresh while you're, because it is literally a three-way dead heat right now.
Wow.
So we'll see who's on top once you give your ruling. But
have you guys
very
seen
close.
Ong Bak?
No, I have not.
You gotta see it. Really? It's amazing.
I'll write that down too.
And he went kind of nuts.
And
which is also a great little
crazy
thing to
but you know what,
throw
you know
that
what,
in there.
He wandered
you know what
in
I
the
thought,
jungle during a movie and just
yeah, he
now,
like,
that, now that the fighting now that the fight is over, I want to tell you how I think I can improve your pitch.
Yeah.
I would see Time Cop. I would see Tom Cop with King Kong Scott. I would see Time Cop with Donnie Yen.
Oh, from,
sure.
Rogue One.
I mean,
but I like the...
Do you think that he can handle the acting?
Tony Jaa?
Yeah.
Do you think there's a lot of acting in Time Cop?
Touche.
Man, yeah, so your pitch, Spencer, is very strange. At the same time, I got it a little bit more than they did. You weren't saying it's a parody movie, but do we want to see Nick Frost do the splits? It does sound a little
what
Paul
Screen
Blart.
Yeah, movie. Like that's like a Screen. Like you like
Paul
what?
Blart.
Yes.
He did a dance movie where he's in a dance contest.
I saw that one.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, salsa, right? Yeah, salsa yeah. Dancing. Yes. So I'm still torn. Time Cop. I was with you. It's a good premise, but then yeah, you went pro Hitler.
That was 100% a joke.
You had
I
anywhere
want
to
make
go.
Sure.
All right, fine. But then you had anywhere to go in time, and you focused on T-Rex.
Yeah,
poachers.
Like a poachers with taking teeth of T-Rex.
That's just one of the
boring
10 mysteries.
Listen,
this is what happens. So that's one of the... That's establishing the premise. That's the first one. He solves it in
so
like...
So they're much more exciting after
8
that?
Minutes. Then he finds out that all these mysteries that he's been going to solve, yeah. There's actually a mega mystery that combines all of them. And I tell you, but it's a big spoiler.
Ooh.
Okay. And then, yeah, Paul, I mean, Twin Diesel does sound kind of fun.
I think it'll be great
you
to
came
see.
Back with that, because Spencer had a blow with you about the, well, he's only good with the teams, but then you said he had two families.
Two families, a good family and a bad family. Like
that took it over the edge for me, so I was close to Kumail, but the two families took me there, so
that,
Paul
I mean,
gets that.
Well,
yeah,
my movie has a ton of families. There's a lot of families.
So
six
Paul's
families.
Definitely in the lead now. So Spencer, you got to get all this right. Point
but there's
to get
no
in the
way
final. If Kumail gets it, you have a point left to go to our speed round.
If it's any consolation to Spencer, right now it's 35% on Twitter voting for Bloodsport, 33% voting for Double Impact, and 32% voting for Time.
Wow, that's a pretty tight
three-way
really
tie.
Should we just make all three?
See them all. Yeah,
yeah.
They want to see all of these movies. They want to see every single one of these movies.
Yeah, Time Cock.
That must exist.
That wasn't on the
poll. Every time you jerk off, you transport yourself. That's a great teenage movie. The first time you jerk off, like, oh, I'm in 1950.
That's the comic. What's the comic? The comic.
Time traveling bong.
What's the time traveling sex? They stay.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
When they, time
sex
stops.
Criminals.
Sex criminals. It's great. Time stops when they have sex. Orgasm. It's a good book.
I got to read that book. I haven't seen
book.
It yet.
It's pretty good.
All right. Round five. This is an epic one. I don't know how we're going to decide it. I'm going to look towards your arguments. The question is, what's the nerdiest movie ever? You can tell me how you're defining that however you want. Kumail, you're first. What is your choice for the nerdiest movie ever?
I'm going to go with The Last Starfighter. Because to me, that's a movie that's such a nerd wet dream where if it's like, I'm really good at video games, which means I can defeat aliens. Doing this isn't useless. And who hasn't had that thought? You're a nerd. People think you're wasting your time. And then you get to look at all the bullies, all the people that made fun of you and be like, I saved Earth because of the thing that you said was wasting my time. What's nerdier than that? Than video games saving the world. It's got aliens, it's got video games, it's got a nerd like conquering over aliens.
All right, good choice, Spencer.
That's pretty nerdy. But what's even nerdier is Scott Pilgrim versus the World. You've got a little milquetoast man who every girl wants to bone. You've got anime references, you've got comic book references, you've got video game references, you've got emo music, you've got a white guy dating a cute Asian girl. This has every nerd stereotype in the book, and it's also based on an obscure comic.
Does it have a really tough Latina woman?
No, I think it does. That's why it's the nerdiest movie ever made.
Paul.
Okay. I want to talk to you about a movie called Sneakers. Sneakers is a movie with Robert Redford, Sidney Poitier, River Phoenix,
classic
Dan
nerds.
Aykroyd.
Those nerds. Sidney Poitier.
David Strathairn. Great
Robert Redford. What a nerd. Robert Redford.
Geek.
Let's let's take a break here. And you guys are not, we have to make a Hollywood movie, all right? We got to make a Hollywood movie, right? And the Last Starfighter, I'm sure, is on a nerd. I'm sure that guy's never played a video game in his life. And Brie Larson's a real nerd. Like, all these people that you're talking about, and Scott Pilgrim, like, that whole cast is not a nerd.
They're not nerds.
Yeah. All right, so let me talk about sneakers. Sneakers is essentially a bunch of nerds who have gotten together to figure out ways to make companies less impenetrable, right? So the whole movie is based on Ben Kingsley and Robert Redford were hackers back in the 60s, and they like broke into the White House.
What were they using? COBOL?
They literally are using
punch cards.
You put like your phone into like the little cradle, like they show the whole thing. And basically Kingsley goes to jail for this. And then Robert Redford escapes.
Oh man, Kingsley, another famous nerd.
Guys, talk about Ocean's 11. Cool guys. These are not cool guys. These are cool guys, but this is like
you're right. Robert Redford is not known to be a cool guy.
All right. We're talking about what makes a nerdy, right?
Butch Cassidy.
I'm not talking about
the Sundance Kid, which everyone is.
Robert Redford.
All right, here's the thing. We're talking to the wrong camera. Here we go. Here's the thing. I just want to go clear here and go. If we're saying who has the nerdiest cast, I'm not making that argument. I'm talking about who has the nerdiest premise, okay? It's about hackers. One of them goes away to jail, and the other one, because he takes the blame for it, the other one doesn't. Then they start a company. Is the company even that exciting? No, not really. It's a company that helps build security systems. Each one of them, like Dan Aykroyd's like really good at like doing code, and River Phoenix has, they're all have like these very nerdy superpowers. They're nothing.
River Phoenix was such a nerd.
Again, we're not making the argument that the cast is nerdy. All right, it's not the casting. It's the premise.
He passed away because he programmed too much, right?
are we saying it's going to be the nerdiest cast? I thought the nerdiest movie ever.
I'm letting you guys
ever.
Define it. What is the nerdiest movie ever?
To me, it's about the premise and the plot. These are about full on nerds. David Strathairn gets put in a car at one point and is able to pinpoint where he was based on the sound of the road because he's blind. The sound of the road on the tires. Like these are like they're all normal things. Everyone could do this, but they're just the people that were disenfranchised, the nerds of their society, the nerds of this thing, and they get called into a very much bigger.
Yeah, Robert Redford really had a hard time finding purchase in modern society.
If I could remember anyone all in right. The Last Starfighter, I would also.
I would say The Last Starfighter.
Let me see his name.
I'm dismissing your movie because I feel like I don't need to argue against it because it has Robert Redford and
the sexiest people alive at the time.
Your movie has a lot of nerd references, but my movie is about nerddom.
It's about your argument, you have to say that it has to have the nerdiest casting because you're only fighting us on casting.
No.
Yes, that's
no,
all you're
I'm,
saying.
Okay, no.
He's saying nerd references versus nerd.
Well, no,
it's really truly about, it's a fantasy situation for a nerd. You play video games. What is the best case scenario that could come from this? You use the skills you use playing video games to defeat actual aliens.
I'm talking about guys that don't even play video games. They're playing even something nerdier. They're like,
that's not nerdy. That's cooler. They actually know how to do
They're
things in the real
nerds,
world.
They're nerds. They don't play video games.
And by the way,
do you know what this word means, Paul?
He's not even a nerd. He's just a kid who lives in the trailer park. And they have one video game that he gets good at. He's not like, oh, I'm a nerd. He's like, oh, my mom's fucking this guy. And then while I'm playing, while my laundry's being done, I'm going
to
play this video game.
What could be more relatable than trying to, what could be nerdier than trying to get really good at one video
game?
He's not trying to get good at it. He just happens to be there. By the way, if it was Pac-Man, we would never have The Last Starfighter. He's not addicted to that game. He just simply is playing it because it's in front of his laundry room.
But he's
it's not in his house.
I take issue with your statement that that's a nerdy premise at all, because people who play video games, having to then go save the world is a burden. You just want to go play video games.
Every character in Sneakers would read Wired. Okay, and be like really into it. Like that guy would, that's nerdy, okay? Your guy is essentially like, I wish I could be fucking some girl, but
yeah,
I
do laundry. That's so nerdy. What's nerdy?
If I beat a game and they told me now you have to go actually do it for real, I'd be like, that is a huge hassle. I liked playing the game.
You're playing the video game IRL.
And the movie's trying to
justify. It's not VR, it's
not nerdy.
R.
The movie's trying to justify to non-nerds why video games are useful. That's not nerdy. That's saying, don't worry, they have a real application in the real world.
So I've heard a lot. Why not Scott Pilgrim? I haven't heard anything
I think Scott Pilgrim... Why is it? Do you have anything?
I do have a couple things
about
Scott Pilgrim. To me, is
It's a very cool movie. It's not cool. A nerdy movie.
It is.
It's what nerds wish they were like.
Very
they
cool.
Want to be that.
No,
detached
I
cool.
No. I think that Scott Pilgrim is a hipster movie.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a nerdy movie. Those are not nerds. Those are hipsters. Those are people who read the Brendan O'Malley or Brian Lee O'Malley comic. Those are people who live in
nerds.
Silver Lake.
Nerds.
No, they're hipsters. Nerds read more superhero stuff. This is more hipster.
This is hipster. This is like everything you're describing is like anime I just feel like that is a movie that you could put in like in Los Angeles or like it's this it's it is the people who are those people are watching the hipster stuff. They're not they're up to date on the hipster.
Yeah, they're very it's cool. Not just anime nerds, it's music nerds too. It's people who are nerdy
but
in
music,
their relationship.
Music
they play,
nerds
these
are like hipsters.
People who listen to Islands and watch Broad City.
They go
these
to
take his Asian girlfriend to a date to play Dance Dance Revolution. This is a nerd.
Dance Dance Revolution is a thing that hipsters co-opt to be like, we're playing video games. You're not. Like you get a Wii.
The nerdiest like, game of all time. Wii. Dance Dance Revolution. Yeah.
That's like the people who like you know like get like it's like you gotta go nerd.
This
there's
is
no,
nerd wish fulfillment. He beats
that's
up Chris
what
Evans.
Mine is.
I think there's one nerd in that. The movie basically revolves around one of the biggest rock stars, right? Because Brie Larson's character is a huge rock star, and that is his ex girlfriend. This guy's dated so many hot girls.
Nerd,
and there's
nerd wish fulfillment.
It's
no,
not wish fulfillment
not
because
nerd.
He's actually dating them.
Yeah, he's not a nerd.
Yes, he is. It's but like the fantasy of like, I can be a nerd. I can look like Michael Cera's elongated Todd bod
no,
and just have tons of chicks chasing after me.
No, Michael Cera is not a nerd. Michael Cera is
he's
a
today's
hipster.
Nerd.
The only thing crazier
you have the 70s nerd where they're all boning down and like starting billion-dollar companies.
Well, like, but that is a nerd, right? Bill Gates is a fucking nerd. Sneakers is a movie made
Bill
for Bill
Gates.
Bill Gates
is a nerd, but none of those people are like Bill Gates in
they
your
were,
movie.
They're Bill Gates
no.
surrogates. These are Bill Gates surrogates. The movie was also made in 19. Like you got to remember, there's different time frames. You know, like Sneakers was made. Let's say
1982.
When was it?
Yeah, made? Last Starfighter is right when video games were coming into the consciousness, and they already got right to it. They were so nerdy.
Point. I would take your point if this guy was obsessed with video games. He's not even obsessed with video games. It's simply the only game in front of his trailer park that he goes to in the
lack
middle of the
of
night.
Lack of access. That's what it is. Like when I was a kid, I just had one video game and I just played it over and over.
Was
that's
the one
not
true. One, yeah, that's
definitely
not true.
Not
true.
What if it was?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, like to me,
right,
it's true.
Final thoughts. Go ahead, Ball.
Okay, final thoughts. If we're talking nerds, we're talking the guys who started Silicon Valley, in my opinion. That's what it is. Sneakers is about a group of people who are kind of an Ocean's 11 team whose all their skill sets are nerd things. They do hacking, they do security, like they are basically
they
a securities firm.
Bradford.
Yeah, they look. Don't judge them on their looks, judge them on how they were written. In 1992, you couldn't make a movie with a nerd cast.
Final
and
thoughts,
I will say
like Revenge of the Nerds.
That doesn't make them into imbeciles. Because like here's the thing.
Those guys
they're
are
like,
nerds.
They're like,
so it was,
but
it
like,
was possible to have nerdy
make,
people
but
playing
can you make
the leads
nerds
in movies.
Because oh, yeah, right, well,
those guys were nerds.
Oh yeah, Anthony Edwards is such a nerd.
He's a nerd
David
in that
Carradine
movie.
Is. All right, go ahead.
I will
Keith
say,
or Keith? Yeah,
Keith.
Yeah,
yeah.
Mine is the only movie that really gets to the heart of nerddom, that comments on nerddom. It says that the things that you're really passionate about,
no.
You
one
can use
thing.
Them to save the world.
One
that's
thing.
That's the ultimate, you're talking about wish fulfillment? This is the ultimate wish fulfillment of
honestly,
nerds.
If that
this
guy had a soccer
case.
Ball in front of his house, he'd kick it into the goal and be like, hey, we put a row around this soccer ball. And
but
and
that's
like,
not what it is. Exactly.
That's the thing. He's not addicted
that's
to
what makes it nerdy.
He's not addicted
that's
to video games. He has one thing that he goes to. It's like a dog.
Does he
Spencer, final thought.
If The Last Starfighter were nerdy, it'd be about a guy who loves video games and then it ends. It just be a wizard.
Seven girls
like sneakers
and then date this. Seven girls seven see, gorgeous people
yeah beautiful
based on
women
beautiful women.
No he has to fight her ex-boyfriends in kung fu fights that he's a nerd
right,
he's never
right.
trained for it he can suddenly do kung fu based on an obscure anime influenced comic book that's so nerdy
the source material is nerdy but the execution of it and the characters I would argue
cool.
are not nerdy. Yes I've read
they're
every one of those
nerdy
Scott
things
Pilgrims.
They're
I've
trying
read.
To make it cool but they have the Zelda noise in the background they have high scores everything turns into
I think
tokens
that, I think
every
that,
reference
I
in that
think
movie
that there are nerds,
and nerds love their references
I think that
nerdy.
Hipsters also love their references and I think hipsters
it's a great movie
damn
great movie.
I
love the movie
it's
love
a
the
great
movie,
movie.
Well this is a subject that Twitter was very, very, very vocal about their picks. At Chewbacca Defense says, Weird Science.
Chewbacca Defense?
Chewbacca Defense.
Okay, got it.
Said, Weird Science, the ultimate male nerd fantasy film.
That's a good one.
Yeah. Mac Pool suggested The Wizard.
Ooh, great one.
Yeah, that's Savage a good Nintendo one. Movie. Sean Forney and a few others suggested Tron.
Harry
Lee
good
suggested
one.
Galaxy Quest. At Ouchus Megahertz, Primer suggested Primer as the nerdiest movie.
Well, ooh. Primer is just like a math movie.
Yeah.
That's pretty nerdy, though.
That is pretty nerdy.
Like by the way, everyone did better than us.
I definitely choices. Watched
I still hold by, yeah.
Anything to add?
Also, if we're just, you know, because it was introduced, hipster is defined dictionarily as a person who follows the latest trends and fashions, especially those regarded as being outside the cultural mainstream. So,
that's not nerds. That's the not latest nerds. Trends is
but
not
nerds.
Nerds
are people who are into something obscure and useless.
Yes, yeah, that's not what hipsters
are. Nerds are defined when you look at like Michael Cera.
Are you saying nerd is a hipster is a nerd?
When you look at Kieran Culkin,
I think they're two different things. Yeah. I'm just introducing the definition for nerd is someone who's boringly studious, particularly in one field of interest.
Yeah,
like my guys, like every one of my guys.
Like
all
my guy
one
is even more specific.
The movie itself is so nerdy.
All right, all right. Based on the arguments, it's not sneakers. I love sneakers. What? I love sneakers. Right. Everyone should. That's a good reboot.
That's a great, right?
Yeah, that's a great film.
It's a great reboot.
But yeah, no, I don't.
Why not? Just tell me why not.
Well, because yeah, your cast is so unnerdy, and they have jobs.
We're judging it on the movie.
Sidney Poitier was an ex-CIA
things. Like, it's kind of a cool job.
He was an ex-CIA.
Okay, so your
opinion. I just want to make sure, and I'll take the loss. I'm not taking the. I'm just gonna say. So, in your opinion, nerds don't have jobs. So, like Steve Jobs, Bill Gates, they're
sure,
like these real.
But it's
Spencer,
not
the
nerdiest.
Guy who created Snapchat.
These two are definitely nerdier than that.
Okay, interesting.
And so it came down to Kumail and Spencer. Yeah, so it is the debate of the. There's a lot of nerd references versus the thing that's in front of them. I think the thing in front of him is pretty damn nerdy, as is the point that you made of a video game saves the world. I gotta give it to Kumail. You get the point.
Yeah.
Shut out.
Sorry, dude.
Sorry, Spencer.
Ooh. Didn't bring it this time. Congratulations.
You did bring it.
You did bring it.
Spencer, you're going to still help us here in the speed round. All right, guys, we are going to go into our speed round. I'll explain it. Before I do, I got to thank NatureBox one more time. Thanks for watching. And
thank
doing
you for
that.
All of our delicious snacks.
Yeah, they're Box. Delicious.
Dark cooking.
You can get the code at screenjunkies.com. Sorry, naturebox.com/screenjunkies to save 50% off your first order. So exclusive to us. Thank you, NatureBox. All right, speed round. Now, guys, this is how this works.
Yeah.
I'm gonna have five more questions, a chance to win five more points. You have three, Paul.
Okay.
You have two, Kumail. This is five more points. The way the speed round works is you'll each have 20 seconds to answer quickly. I'm gonna name a question. You have to answer immediately.
And is it like to him and then to
you're
me?
You're both answering at the same time. If you both say the same answer, it's whoever said it first.
Okay.
So if you still, okay, if you well, both say
give us a sample round. You guys do a sample round.
Sure.
I don't know what questions right. are, but
Dan and, yeah. and Spencer, ready? We'll give them a quick example.
Yeah.
Best Tom Hanks movie.
Big oh wow.
Castaway.
Okay.
Get it?
Got
and then
it.
They each
yes.
get 20 seconds. He went first, and then he'll get 10
got
second
it. Okay,
final.
Perfect. Got it.
Okay. All right, here we go. So just names, shout it out yes. first, and then I'll explain as we go.
The bell.
All right, and then you'll hear the bell when your time okay. is done. You'll have 20 seconds. All right, here we go. What is the most underrated action one-liner of all time?
Your luggage.
Luggage weapon two. Oh, right, Mike, I have it. One, two. All right.
What is it?
Diplomatic immunity.
Okay. Kumail, you're first, so you're going to say your luggage. Tell me why your luggage from Eraser is the best. Time starts when you begin speaking.
It's such a great line. He kills a fucking crocodile and goes, your luggage. Even if the crocodile was alive, the line would be lost on him. It's just for the joy of delivering a great line. And who has crocodile skin suitcases? They're very expensive, and he had the presence of mind to come up with that with an obscure kind of material for a suitcase. Your luggage.
All right, Paul?
Lethal Weapon 2, the main bad guy is a South African diplomat. How are you gonna kill a South African diplomat in a cool, adventurous way? So the way he gets out of everything is because he has diplomatic immunity. So when Murtaugh shoots him at the end, he goes, your diplomatic community has been revoked. And I was like that is the
time,
hardest
time.
Thing to get.
10 seconds last. Go ahead, 10. 10 seconds left. When you begin speaking, you have 10 final rebuttal seconds.
Rebuttal.
Against
rebut
him.
Or add more.
Add more okay. or rebut him. 10 seconds.
I will say that's not a badass line. That's just him saying the truth of what happened. There's no poetry
no,
to it. There's no poetry
shot
to
him
it. There's poetry!
All right, sorry. Yeah, don't, you can't overtalk in this one. Yeah, now you have your 10 seconds, Paul.
Oh, I have 10 seconds, too. You can interrupt me. But no, it's the coolest way to do it. Revoked, shot him in the head. It was great.
It's a plot point, not a fucking...
No, you got it. Like, the best way is to dispose of people. So, like, I feel like to figure out a way to use diplomatic immunity to get rid of your badass...
Time. All right. We'll get there in the next
one. Sorry, sorry.
They got about equal time. Yeah,
it's we'll figure it out.
Based on those arguments, Spencer's helping me now and on the couch. What do you think based on the arguments, Spencer?
I got to give that to Kumail. I mean, the fact that even if the crocodile was alive.
That was pretty good. When I heard your luggage, I knew I was lost. That was a good one.
Sugarman on the couch. Dan, what do you guys think?
Yeah, that's the point of it. It was said just for the benefit of himself.
For nobody.
I kind of like that.
All right. I agree. Sugarman, are you on the same team?
I'm on board.
Okay. Okay, great. So you get the first point, and that puts us to a tie. That's all right, still four more. Here we go. Number two. Is this a bargain bin? Yes. Okay. So don't do it yet. I'm going to pop up two DVDs from our bargain bin. The fans submitted this. You're going to see two films up on the TV. Yell which one we should buy.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Here we go.
Marley and Me.
Oh, good. You both picked it. So. I heard Marley and Me first. So that's you, Paul?
Okay,
right?
Yes.
And hold on, Marley and Me, and Paul, I'm sorry, Kumail, you get Air Bud.
Yeah, can we see those covers again?
Yes, you can pop them up for your arguments, okay? Or can we put it in a split screen, or is that too hard to do? All right. Time begins when you begin speaking. Paul, you're first. You'll have 20 seconds.
I'm a cynic. I have made a podcast about watching bad movies, so I go into everything with a slight, like, whatever. I saw Marley and Me. That shit made me cry. It is a sweet movie about a dog. I don't even own a dog, and I cry because it actually talks to the human experience. It is a sweet, nice, down-the-middle movie that you don't often get.
All right, 20 seconds begins when you begin speaking.
Can I see my thing and then you can start the time? Okay, it's a dog playing basketball because there was a loophole in the rules. I shouldn't even have to defend it, but if you see, there's a commentary that has all those little baby dogs talking. That's the commentary. I mean, how can you beat that? Those little baby dogs. It says with the little buddy's family, there's a whole commentary. There's a dog commentary.
Okay, 10 seconds, Paul.
First of all, that dog commentary is going to get boring in a second. Right? You're gonna have to. I want to talk about a movie that you can watch with your family, a movie that you can put on, and everyone in the room will be happy. It's gonna be something that lives on your shelf.
10 seconds, Kumail.
How many dogs play basketball in your movie? I think none.
Actually,
am I right?
One of them, Marley.
The dog dunks a basketball and he's
dunks
good
my
at
heart
it.
Into he's my a, chest, but wait, he does.
Hold on, you get more time. Sorry, go ahead.
I lost my train of thought, but he's a dog who can play basketball well. He doesn't just play basketball, he is good at it. I would rather see him as Steel.
This is more than 10 seconds.
All right, 2 seconds.
Okay, I'm just talking about this. That's a fucking dumb movie. Open your heart for once in your life, you cold-hearted son of a bitches.
We're even. Going to Sugarman on the couch, based on those arguments.
I would go with Paul, because based on Kumail's argument, I'm not sure if he's seen the movie.
Yeah,
Paul got me with, that commentary will get boring.
Yeah. I thought that the commentary point might have been an arrow to the heart, but Paul did bring out the legitimacy of it.
Most commentary.
Wait, you guys are assuming. Don't you want to watch and learn for yourself?
I have faith it's going to get boring. Spencer, what do you think?
I'm kind of curious about the commentary, but the rare moment of sincerity from Paul put
it
on the top.
It was very cynical. It was a cynical use of sincerity. You don't believe that. You didn't cry.
Putting those air buddies in there, making they're going to milk you.
Lie.
You fell right into the
trap.
All right,
well, Paul, you got it back on the board. 4-3.
Fake sincerity.
Here we go. Three more questions. Here it goes. What's the worst ever movie based on a video game?
Oh,
Mario
I got this
Brothers.
On. Okay, Street Fighter.
Street Fighter with Van Damme.
Yes.
Okay, versus Mario Brothers. Kumail, you said it first, so time begins when you begin speaking.
So John Leguizamo and Bob Hoskins, the city that they're in is called Dinohattan because instead of them, men, they descended from dinosaurs. It's called Dinohattan. And the original Mario doesn't have that much dinosaur stuff in it. It's just Yoshi. And they have like mutations and all this stuff. It's nothing like the video game.
Kumail, you're wrong. That's the alternate world that they are in. They actually live in a normal Manhattan. The second thing I'm going to talk about is this movie, Street Fighter. It has nothing to do with the game. They don't even have all the characters. Like, the idea of Street Fighter is like amazing fights. Jean-Claude Van Damme's like the leader of an army, and it's basically General Bison, and that's it. There's no other characters from the entire world.
I will say Street Fighter is Raul Julia's final role, and how dare you say that's the worst video game movie of all time just for his memory. He's a great actor. I will say you cannot say that.
They simply just took the title Street Fighter. At least they were plumbers.
They have Guile. They have Blanca. Blanca's in it.
For a second.
Yes.
They were plumbers. They broke the entire world.
All right, we got equal time on that, right?
Yeah, okay. I gave Paul a little extra time.
Spencer, based on those arguments.
Tough. I didn't love either argument, man. Gotta be honest with you. I don't know about the fact, I gotta give it to Kumail by a hair because of Raul Julia respecting the man's memory, and that was one good part of the movie. And I don't think the plumbing was ever a big part of Mario Brothers, so the fact that was in the movie almost counts against
us.
Yes,
well, you have to get them into the world. The entire video game is them going into pipes.
No, but
go into pipes.
And Sugarman, what do you think based on the arguments?
There's a pipe right there.
This is a very difficult decision. I think that Kumail brought up something legitimately great about Paul's movie, and so for that reason, I'm going to give him the point.
I just want to say to you before Sugarman, before I hear your thing.
No, you can't. You don't get extra time. You get extra time. Sugarman, go ahead.
I'm so sorry he tried to interrupt you.
I'm so sorry, man.
This is going to sound...
I love that shirt.
Okay. Yeah. I'd actually go with Kumail as well. I don't really... Mario movies had more of a plot they should have connected to. I think that's what he brought up with Street Fighter. Right. I don't really know what they would really connect to anyway. So.
Oh,
we're going to give Kumail the point. I think we're all in agreement. But Paul, did you have something to add?
Yeah, I want to say, I would watch Super Mario Brothers any day over Street Fighter. Street Fighter is a terrible movie.
By the way, I'd probably watch Raul Julia, though. I'd rather watch his last
performance. Have you seen it?
It's bad, but I'd still rather watch his last performance.
Paul, genuinely, outside of this, I would totally disagree. I would watch Street Fighter over Mario Brothers.
Yeah, Mario
Brothers.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, me too.
All right. Interesting.
All right, here we go. We have two movies here. We're tied up. This is number four, right?
Left.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
I'm going to name two films. Tell me which one we should get.
Which
one should we watch?
Is it a bargain bin again?
No, it's not on the visual, but these two films, which one should we watch? Con Air or Air Force One?
Con Air.
Air Force One.
Oh, wow. That worked out.
All right.
Hold on. Con Air for Paul and Air Force One for Kumail. Okay, go ahead, Paul.
Con Air is, as we call it on our podcast, a thank God this movie got made. It's Michael Bay at the height of Michael Bay-ness. I mean, it's a plane full of prisoners, so you get this amazing kind of cannonball run of this guy's a rapist, this guy's a murderer, and Nicolas Cage is a good guy who's been in prison for the wrong reasons. It has an entire fight.
20 seconds.
It's the president fighting terrorists on an airplane. Get off my plane. That's super. Just a movie that's set on Air Force One where nothing happens would be very great. But him fighting terrorists and it's Harrison Ford. Harrison Ford kicks the shit out of everybody in that movie. Better actor, better screen presence.
All right, 10 seconds.
Steve Buscemi may or may not have eaten a young girl in Con Air. That is a plot hole that they leave open. You got Nicolas Cage with that long flowing hair and the wife beater shirt. This is an iconic movie.
10 seconds.
I saw Air Force One on a plane and I have never been the same since. Watch it on a plane.
All right. Spencer, based on those arguments.
Wow. Did Michael Bay direct Con Air?
No, Simon West.
Simon West.
Bruckheimer.
I meant Bruckheimer.
Oh, that's
wrong. Sorry, I meant Bruckheimer.
That's way wrong. That's wrong.
It's so wrong.
It does feel Michael Bay,
though. Yeah, it feels very Michael Bay. I'm still going to give it to Paul just on the weakness of your rebuttal.
I don't know either of those movies that well.
So, yeah.
Dan Sugarman, thoughts?
I would also side with Paul.
Yes.
I would side with Paul as well.
All right.
Con Air probably is a more fun movie.
All right, Paul, you got it.
It is, but not as good as The Rock. I think The Rock is better.
Well, The Rock's legitimate.
You got to get this point, Kumail, to elicit a tiebreaker. So here we go. If they remade the film Roadhouse, who should star?
Ooh, this is a good question.
Oh, my God.
I'm thinking about this too. I want to pick the right person.
10 seconds.
Rock.
I would say Michelle Rodriguez.
Ooh.
Ronda Rousey is actually in the remake.
Well, they're not doing it.
You picked The Rock. You picked The Rock?
I picked The Rock.
Okay, and Michelle Rodriguez. Okay, I heard Rock first.
Here's the deal. The Rock is good in anything, and here's the other thing about The Rock. He can actually have a heart, and I think that's the toughest thing about the character of Roadhouse. You gotta believe that he is, like, in tune with himself. He doesn't want to fight, and I think The Rock has the body, and I think he can also pull off just the subtle things. That's the hardest part of that character. It's just not a kick-ass guy. He can kick-ass, but you also have to buy that he's cool.
My movie is an action movie about gender roles and how people see women and men and what they should be doing. And this is a badass bar where the dudes are fucking doing awful stuff, and this woman shows up, and they're like, "All right, what's she gonna do?" And then she kicks their ass. It's a movie we need right now. It's International Women's Day yesterday.
I'm going to disagree with this right here, because here's the thing. Roadhouse isn't about the fights. Yes, he can fight, but it's about a man who doesn't want to fight, and then he is drawn to fight to save the town. And
well, this is a different take on it. I don't want to remake that same movie. I want to put a different thing in it, and this is about people's perception of her and what she does with it, and she doesn't want to fight either, but she's good at it, and she needs to.
He's taking away the only good thing, and by the way, Michelle Rodriguez couldn't handle all that Zen-like stuff and throat rips.
Five more seconds.
Oh, I do.
He over five.
Oh,
seconds.
I thought we had 2 seconds of rebuttal.
I just feel like seeing Michelle Rodriguez beat up a bunch of dudes is gonna be awesome.
All right,
same argument. I'm really
I love how he's getting into this. They're both getting into this.
Yeah, no, it's great.
Dan Sugarman, going to you first based on their arguments.
Wow, these are two different takes, and I like both takes. I like both takes. Yeah. I think I lean toward Kumail, if only because he said it's not just a remake of the original, that it's a new spin on it. And
all she does is beat people up, right?
Dude.
All
right. True. This is true. But, you know, Roadhouse was kind of about the fights.
Yeah, it was totally is about the fights.
I want to see both, if I'm being honest. I wish there was a Roadhouse A and a Roadhouse B, but if I have to choose, I'm going with Kumail.
Or does she play the Sam Elliott role?
There you go.
Oh, we make hybrid mashes up. So you agree, Sugarman?
Yeah, because I don't think you cast The Rock if it's not about the fights. So I would go with Kumail.
Sugarman drops it. Spencer.
Wow. See, I was going with Paul because I think you pitched an interesting movie, but it was a casting question. You gave me a lot more of why the actor is a better fit for the role. You could have put any woman in place of Michelle Rodriguez.
No, but a woman that you believe.
No, listen to me. I think he's right.
Yeah, they're all right, but I gotta go with them. I give Kumail the point. That gives us one more chance. Tiebreaker here. Really good. I do want to watch both of those.
Much like Jean-Claude Van Damme, we're in sudden death now.
Yes. All right, okay. Ooh, two good questions here. All right, I'm going to go with number one. Here we go. Tiebreakers for all the marbles. Who's the best member of the Fast and the Furious crew?
Oh, Tyrese.
I will say Paul Walker.
Oh. Tyrese versus Paul Walker. Okay, so Paul, you can take your time.
If you know the character names.
Ryan and Tyrese is...
It's
not
city
Taj,
name,
that's
right?
He's Roman.
Roman, yeah.
There you go. Okay, Roman versus Brian. Time begins when you begin speaking. Whenever you're ready, Paul.
Roman adds the legitimate comedy to Fast and Furious. Without Roman, it's a straight up... like. I would argue that Roman and Tyrese,
Ludacris
and Tyrese balance the comedy, but the fun thing about Roman is he never knows what the plan is until immediately he's like, wait, we're shooting these cars out of a plane. He's like, yeah, you're in a car with a parachute on it. Like,
I don't know these movies.
I think Paul Walker was the heart of these movies and always. And I think in the last one, he's really, really, really good at it. And the last scene that he has with The Rock when he says goodbye to him.
Vin Diesel.
Yeah, sorry. With Vin Diesel. It's like genuinely really, really moving. Like I cried watching that movie. And emotionally, of all the movies, his storyline in the last movie had the most emotional impact for me.
10 seconds, Paul.
These movies don't click ultimately until you get to 5 when they bring in Tyrese. Paul Walker was in 3 of them before that, and they were the run-of-the-mill kind of action movies. First one's good, second one...
I would say number 5, the addition of The Rock had more to do with why those movies are good than the addition of Tyrese.
You haven't seen him. You don't know.
I have seen him.
You don't know him.
No, I do. I'm just saying that. Wait. So I think it's the addition of The Rock. I don't think anybody will say Tyrese is the best part of those movies.
You're laughing.
Ooh.
Makes it a fun
Do we have equal time there, Dan?
Roughly.
Okay.
Yeah. Roughly.
Yeah. You both feel fair? You got your points across?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
I haven't.
All right, here we go. I have an opinion, but I'm going to Spencer first.
That was tough, man.
That was tough.
Two good fighters. Two good fighters, yeah. Tyrese showed up in the second one, right?
Yes.
He was in the one in Miami.
Okay, but then you were quoting...
But he went away for
Paul
two
Walker
other movies.
...being the heart, but the scene you referenced, I'm pretty sure Paul Walker was CGI.
Yeah, that was old footage.
Yeah. The heart of Paul Walker.
Okay, yeah, fair.
His brother.
I just got more from Paul Scheer. I'm sorry.
Dan Sugarman?
Very different. Two different arguments. Two different takes on it.
I mean, can I just say one other thing?
No. No, you cannot.
I lean a little bit towards Paul because I think he gave me kind of what Tyrese gives to every movie as opposed to just the seventh one. I thought the Camilles was very focused on the seventh one, and I felt the Tyrese argument was more about the flavor he adds to each Fast and Furious movie, so I lean towards Paul.
All right, well, it comes down to me, and I gotta say...
Wait, Sugarman didn't say
it. Oh, sorry, yeah, Sugarman?
Bless Paul's memory, but I would go with...
You're doing that because everybody else voted for it.
It matters what I think. Yeah. And I think I never really considered Tyrese's role, but you really defined why that role is important. He knows there's a rocket on the car, but he's got to be the one to say, what do we do with a rocket on the car? I think Paul Scheer takes
he's
it.
Like,
Paul Scheer gets the point. And that's a win for Mr. Scheer.
Finally get a win.
What, have you done the show? Yeah,
no.
Well, you guys are legit movie nerds, so I'm glad you came back. And that was so much fun. Bravo, you did it. Let's get some plugs here. I want to thank you and make sure everyone goes and sees the Go 90 series, Drive Share.
It's totally free. You don't have to sign up. It's not like an account or anything. Just go to go90.com and watch it. It's totally there. No, it's not like a Hulu or Netflix. It's just a website, go90.com.
Check it out. Go watch.
Amazing people in
Kumail,
it.
Kumail, thank you so much for coming. Silicon Valley starting up soon, and obviously set the Surrey reminder
Silicon Valley comes back on HBO April 23rd. You can watch
start watching on April 16th for Veep, and you can just check it out.
Wait, do I get more time now?
Yes. It's after Game of Thrones, right?
April 23rd. I mean, if we're looking at numbers, then, you know. but if you're looking at
all
Emmys,
their nerds jack up their numbers so high they hack into the system.
If we're looking at Emmy wins, then we're not as good. We've lost some of the biggest awards there are. We haven't won very many of them. But April 23rd, we start. You can watch the other three seasons on HBO Go or HBO Now. And then my movie, The Big Sick, opens in select cities June 23rd and then goes wide July 14th. Please watch it.
Yes, I'm excited for it. Spencer Gilbert, Honest Trailers, anything else you'd like to plug?
You're on Screen Junkies, come back.
Yes. Good work, though. Sorry you were pointless, but...
It happens. That was completely... I was actually pointless.
Yeah. You served a very great point. You had some good laughs there. Dan Murrell on the couch. Thank you so much.
I was just kind of thinking, given the score, I know it's kind of... Spencer just may as well not have been here.
Yeah, it was pointless. Yep.
I do like that Spencer is giving a test run to our new marketing slogan. You're on Screen Junkies, come back.
You're already here.
You did it.
So thank you. Thanks for watching. And this is really fun to watch.
Fun show. Michael Sugarman, what a show to come on. What'd you think?
I had a really great time. Thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you for all your support over watching from Plus in the beginning and everything. And thank you all at home. I'm Andy Signor. You can find me there. We'll try and do an after fight. We'll text you. I don't know how much time we have. That was a long one again. But thanks again to these wonderful people. Come back anytime. And
we'll see you next week.
Thanks so much, everybody.
Thanks to NatureBox for sponsoring this episode. For more information, click the link in the description. And right now, you'll save even more because NatureBox is offering Screen Junkies fans 50% off your first order when you go to naturebox.com/screenjunkies. Again, that's naturebox.com/screenjunkies for 50% off your first order.